Thank you very much for being here. Staff, close the door there. Appreciate it. Good afternoon. I'm Dennis Kucinich, Chairman of the Domestic Policy Subcommittee of the Committee of Oversight and Government Reform. Welcome to today's hearing on foreclosures, what needs to change in the administration's response. Today's hearing is a continuation of the subcommittee's series of hearings examining the characteristics of the ongoing residential foreclosure crisis and the impact of the administration's response. Now, without objection, the chair and the ranking minority member will have 5 minutes to make opening statements, followed by opening statements not to exceed 3 minutes by any other member who seeks recognition. And without objection, members and witnesses may have 5 legislative days to submit a written statement or extraneous materials for the record. I want to acknowledge the presence of my colleague from Ohio, Congressman Turner from the Dayton area. Welcome. I appreciate you being here. I know that you have another hearing to go to, and we're going to move through the opening statements and give you a chance to be heard from as well. So, did you have that letter? Okay. This subcommittee began holding hearings on the subject of the foreclosure crisis and solutions to it 3 years ago. Since that time, we've met 9 times on the subject. It's not hyperbole to say that this is the worst economic crisis to hit America since the Great Depression. The fallout from the crash in the housing market and the recession that has overtaken our country has left no community in the country untouched. Nearly every level of economic activity has been affected negatively. Nationally, the unemployment rate is approximately 10%, and in some states, it's nearly 15%. Foreclosures continue. 2.9 million borrowers received foreclosure notices in 2009, and it's predicted nearly 2.5 million more borrowers will lose their homes to foreclosure this year. According to the most recent data, more than 15%, 1 in 6 of all mortgages are in trouble. 2.6 million borrowers have missed at least 3 payments on their mortgages, making them seriously delinquent. This is double the level of 1 year ago and is the highest number of delinquencies on record since 1972, according to the Mortgage Bankers Association. Now, let's be clear. This foreclosure crisis started well before the current administration came into office. But like the Great Depression, the administration that inherited the crisis will be judged for how they respond. And that judgment can be as harsh as if they had created the crisis themselves. The American people expect and the American people deserve bold initiatives from their government to help as many people as possible. Unfortunately, in my opinion, much time has been wasted by relying on lenders and investors to choose to modify loans and keep people in their homes. Indeed, even as this administration quickly created a program that the previous one wouldn't even consider, the Making Home Affordable program, it continued to rely on the charitable impulses of the industry that has nearly bankrupted the nation. But the industry that received a $1 trillion bailout has been unwilling to absorb the losses, to write down bad debts, and their recalcitrance is holding up the resolution of the foreclosure crisis. Thus, the administration's centerpiece loan modification program, known as the Home Affordable Modification Program, or HAMP, has not lived up to its high expectations. Treasury points out that 75% of the 1 million or so borrowers who've been offered modifications under the program are making their payments. And it's just a matter of borrowers getting all their documents to lenders. And certainly, for a program that is just under a year since its creation, the efforts to publicize it and encourage participation are laudable, but it's also severely flawed. It doesn't address one of the key problems facing borrowers, the problem of negative equity, of a house that is worth less than the mortgage. It is marred by geographical disparities, and its affordability objectives rely upon stretching out the payments an approach that can saddle the borrower with more debt, not less, and which makes sense only on the assumption that home values are eventually going to go right back up. Now, on Friday, this administration announced a pilot initiative to distribute $1.5 billion in TARP money to five states. That list did not include Ohio or other states that were hit harder and earlier by the foreclosure crisis. Even if Ohio had been included in that list, it would not have been enough to make a meaningful headway in the crisis. In fact, the state set a record for foreclosures last year, the 14th year in a row of increases. But as we will hear today, no matter how grim the statistics are, there are still plenty of people in Ohio and in many other states that are hoping and waiting for some relief. Americans will be able to tell if Washington is faking it. Millions of people will have personal knowledge of whether or not the government gave them real help, which for many borrowers must necessarily include principal reduction. There is still time in Ohio and in communities across America to create a positive and fruitful legacy of this administration's response to the foreclosure crisis. My hope is that this administration feels the urgency and the need to make this decisive difference. I want to, in addition to acknowledging our first witness, Ms. Caldwell, I also want to acknowledge the presence in the audience of the treasurer of Cuyahoga County, Ohio, Jim Rokakis, who has been a stalwart in not just examining this, but this matter of the impact of foreclosures, but has really been a leader nationally in suggesting solutions and the way forward. So, Treasurer Rokakis, I appreciate your presence here today. We also have a local TV reporter, Bill Shields, who actually did an investigation that we're going to give this committee a quick glimpse of in the same panel a little bit later that Mr. Rokakis is on. So welcome to Washington. I'm going to proceed right now to the opening statement from our ranking member, Congressman Jordan of Ohio. You may proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me, too, thank Mr. Rokakis for being with us and Ms. Caldwell. I know they were both there in Cleveland when we had the field hearing a few months back. Mr. Chairman, we do appreciate this hearing today. Homeowners across the country are suffering. Just last week, the Mortgage Bankers Association reported that the combination of loans in foreclosure and one payment behind in their mortgage was over 15%, highest in the history of the survey. Meanwhile, home prices keep falling. U.S. banks are posting their sharpest declines in lending since 1942. At the recent field hearings of this subcommittee in Atlanta and Cleveland, we have received overwhelming evidence of the failure of the administration's policies and programs to stem the tide of mortgage defaults and foreclosures. In addition to trade organizations, think tanks, and government accountability groups have produced reams of reports that demonstrate how the administration's most active program, HAMP, has not only failed to accomplish the administration's promise of assisting 3 to 4 million American homeowners, but is actually harming homeowners and the broader economy. This harm, Mr. Chairman, can be measured in several ways. First, the administration's mortgage modification efforts are costing taxpayers as much as $75 billion. Since the President took office, he has told the American people time and again that the answer to our economic problems is more government spending and new government programs. And time and again, this administration has told the American people that they should expect a return on their investments through bailouts and stimulus spending. And they have been told that they will be able to track this return through an unprecedented level of transparency and accountability. But once again, the administration is breaking these promises to the American people in the face of widespread bipartisan criticism of HAMP. For example, the Treasury Department has retreated into secrecy by halting the dissemination of information on the program's website that would allow the public to track the program's success rate. The public is also harmed when the government spends their money on failed programs. It is doubly harmed when the government tries to disguise its failures by hiding information from the American people. We've also learned that many of the people who have received temporary assistance through the administration's programs are now discovering they are ineligible for the long-term mortgage modification. As the New York Times recently reported, this means that many Americans are throwing their money into homes that they believe the government would help them keep, only to find out thousands of dollars later that they will face foreclosure anyway. Delaying foreclosures, Mr. Chairman, does not help the many Americans who are fighting to keep their jobs or find new ones. Delayed foreclosures only serve to prolong the economic hardship, drain them of much-needed resources, and defraud them the opportunities to find more affordable housing options. In fact, it seems that the only good thing that the administration's efforts have accomplished is to reinforce in the minds of the American people the reality that technocratic tinkering is not an effective solution to our economic problems. The only viable long-term solution is to keep more Americans in their homes and in their jobs. For that matter, it is a broad-based economic recovery built on the foundation of free markets, fiscal responsibility, and limited government that has made our nation strong and prosperous for more than 200 years. Mr. Chairman, I would also ask unanimous consent to enter into the record a staff report that was released this morning along with ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Issa, the title of which is Treasury Department's Mortgage Modification Programs, a Failure Prolonging the Economic Crisis.
So ordered.
Thank you.
Without objection.
Yield back.
Chair recognizes Mr. Cummings, Maryland.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I thank you for holding this hearing. In my 14 years in Congress, I've devoted more energy to addressing the current foreclosure crisis than almost any other issue facing our nation. Because of that, I thank you for holding this hearing, as well as the field hearings in Atlanta, Cleveland, and for using the Domestic Policy Subcommittee to shine a light on this very tragic problem. I also thank all of today's witnesses for joining us. Your input is crucial to our developing real solutions for real people who are suffering real problems. More than a year ago, I decided that we were not doing enough to address foreclosures in my district in Baltimore. So I hired someone in my district office to work only on helping our constituents keep their houses. Most of us only have 20 employees. That's between Washington and the district. And I then soon discovered I needed another one. So literally 10% of my staff only deal with foreclosures, keeping people in their houses. After I hired the first one, I decided that there was still more that we could do. We figured out that the most common barriers to mortgage modifications were lost paperwork, understaffed lender call centers, and lender and servicer denials without any explanation. And another one was just the idea that sometimes when they got a hold of the lender, the lender just simply did not take the time to work with the borrower. And I want to say that it was not always in a good faith manner, but I won't go that far. But one thing that we did discover is that once my staff member would sit down a lot of times and go over the paperwork with the borrower, we discovered that, I'd say about 80% of those cases, they were able to get a modification. So this past Saturday, we held our third foreclosure prevention workshop in Baltimore. Over the last year, these events have brought together some 3,000 people from my district, and by the way, from all over the country. We had over 25 lenders and created the opportunity to keep hundreds, if not thousands, of families in their homes. We discovered that something as simple as a face-to-face meeting, this is not rocket scientist stuff, a face-to-face meeting does not seem that important, but for the men and women who approached me on Saturday, literally in tears after negotiating modification, it meant everything. But there are others for whom the options are severely limited. They're unemployed. We can do a lot of good with President Obama's mortgage modification infrastructure. I watched it happened on Saturday in Baltimore, but the plight of 14.8 million unemployed Americans demand that we do even more. And more is these three things. First, we need mortgage assistance, whether through grants or loans, for unemployed persons while they continue to look for work. We managed to get $3 billion in the Wall Street Reform and Consumer Protection Act, but that funding is far from a done deal. I was pleased that the President's recently announced 4-HM program, help for the hardest hit housing markets, will include assistance to the unemployed, as well as those who are underwater in their mortgages. While I would have hoped to see the program implemented in more than just the 5 hardest hit housing markets, we have to start somewhere. The second thing we need to do is we need a real jobs package. Senate's passage yesterday of the $15 billion so-called jobs bill is better than nothing, but it is not nearly enough, and it's anticipated we'll move on that in the House this week. Finally, we need job training programs that allow workers to adapt and improve. As CBO Director Douglas Elmendorf said on Tuesday to another committee, which I sit on, the Joint Economic Committee, so many of the lost jobs simply are not coming back. New jobs will come from new firms who embrace new technology and innovation. Worker training, whether through community college, career centers, or traditional four-year schools, must be part of the long-term solution. Clearly, we need a comprehensive strategy to help the unemployed, one that should include the elements I just mentioned, but today's task, foreclosure prevention, is the first and biggest element of that solution. And so, Mr. Chairman, I look forward to the testimony, and I want to thank the witnesses. And with that, I yield back.
Chair recognizes Mr. Turner of Ohio.
Thank you, Chairman Kucinich. I want to thank you for your leadership and efforts in the areas of the mortgage foreclosure crisis and also the issues of how you've looked to protect families who are in Ohio as we struggle with how to address the issue of the mortgage foreclosure crisis and its effects on our neighborhoods. I want to thank you and the ranking member for holding this hearing today to focus on the effectiveness of the administration's Home Affordable Modification Program in helping struggling families facing foreclosure and stay in their homes. My congressional district, as well as the entire state of Ohio, has been significantly impacted by the current foreclosure crisis. In the counties located within Ohio's congressional 3rd district, there have been over 6,000 housing foreclosures reported in 2008 alone. While Congress has made attempts to address the root causes of the housing crisis, we need to continue to improve federal housing policies in order to find new solutions to address these challenges. We must conduct a comprehensive reevaluation of our federal, state, and local housing policies in order to stabilize the housing market, keep people in their homes, and help displaced families return to their homes. To better understand how the greater Dayton area has been particularly affected by the current housing crisis, in August, I convened a forum in coordination with the Northeast Midwest Institute, consisting of two panels to examine the impact of the housing crisis on our community and to discuss the federal response. The Northeast Midwest Institute is a Washington, D.C.-based nonprofit, nonpartisan research organization dedicated to economic vitality, environmental quality, and regional quality for Northeast and Midwest states. The first panel was composed of Miami Valley leaders who discussed the effects of the housing crisis in the region. We have in attendance today Jim McCarthy, who's in the back of the room, from the Miami Valley Fair Housing Center, who's previously testified before this committee on the issues of the effects in Miami Valley. The second panel was composed of federal policy experts who discussed the federal response to this crisis. Both panels highlighted recent successes and identified some of the serious challenges we face as we continue to determine the appropriate role of federal government addressing the housing issues in our region. The panelists also provided considerations that address the current legal and regulatory framework governing the housing and mortgage lending markets, the prevalence of fraudulent mortgage lending practices, the effectiveness of certain housing tax credits, grants, and programs, as well as providing a complete reevaluation of federal housing policies and their impact on communities across the nation. Today, I present the report that summarizes a number of the policy considerations based on the individual testimonies and discussions held at the Housing Forum that may assist us in helping families stay in their homes and stabilize our neighborhoods. The report entitled The Impact of the Housing Crisis on Local Communities and Federal Response discusses preventing predatory lending by increasing financial product transparency and preventing the issuance of inappropriate loan products, streamlining the mortgage servicing industry, standardizing housing counseling and loan modification regulations, improving the neighborhood stabilization program, and building local organizational capacity in distressed communities, and rethinking the impact of low-income housing tax credits on older cities. The report also provides Congress, government officials, and housing industry with a thorough understanding of the implications of federal housing policies' effects on cities like Dayton. With that, I would like to offer the report, if without objection, for the record. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I thank you for your support for that, and I also thank you for your advocacy on behalf of Ohio within this program that's the subject matter of this hearing. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman, and I thank you for the opportunity to work with you on this, and also my other colleagues from on this committee. We are now going to hear testimony from the witnesses. I would like to statements from members of Congress, and the subcommittee is going to receive testimony from a witness of the first panel. Ms. Phyllis Caldwell is the chief of the Office of Homeownership Preservation at the U.S. Department of Treasury. Ms. Caldwell oversees management of the Obama administration's Making Home Affordable program. Previously, Ms. Caldwell was president of the Washington area's Women's Foundation, a public foundation solely focused on improving the lives of women and girls by fostering philanthropic giving in the Washington metropolitan area. Ms. Caldwell, I want to thank you for being before this subcommittee. It is the policy of the Committee on Oversight and Government Reform to swear in all witnesses before they testify, and I would ask that you please rise and raise your hand. Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. Let the record reflect that the witness answered in the affirmative. Ms. Caldwell, I ask that you give a brief summary of your testimony. Please try to keep that summary under 5 minutes in duration. Your complete written statement will be included in the hearing record, and I ask that you proceed.
Well, Chairman Kucinich, Ranking Member Jordan, thank you for the opportunity to testify today about the Treasury Department's comprehensive initiatives to stabilize the U.S. housing market. It has been 1 year since the launch of Making Home Affordable, of which the Home Affordable Modification Program, or HAMP, is a key component. Today, HAMP is making significant progress with over 1 million trial modifications started. Yet, we recognize that challenges remain. We continue to monitor and update program guidelines to improve implementation and help more homeowners. At the end of January, nearly 1 million homeowners were in active trial or permanent modifications. More than 116,000 homeowners now have permanent modifications, nearly doubling the number from December. An additional 76,000 permanent modifications have been offered and are waiting only for the borrower's signature. Homeowners in modifications are achieving significant savings on their mortgage payments, over $500 per month on average. And HAMP has proven that it is helping homeowners who have faced real financial hardship. Nearly 60% of borrowers in permanent modifications have faced a reduction in income, including loss of wages or hours, or unemployment of a spouse. But it's important to remember that HAMP is just one part of the administration's broader effort to stabilize the housing market. Together, the Treasury and the Federal Reserve have purchased over $1 trillion in agency mortgage-backed securities, helping to keep interest rates at historic lows. Millions of Americans have been able to refinance their mortgages into lower-rate, 30-year fixed-rate mortgages, saving an average of $1,500 per year on a refinance. And thanks to the recently extended first-time home buyer tax credit, more Americans are now able to re-enter the housing market and stem the slide in home values. Through HUD's Neighborhood Stabilization Program, hundreds of communities across the country are taking important steps to restore and maintain properties in neighborhoods that have been hardest hit by concentrated foreclosures and home price declines. Finally, the administration last Friday announced that it will allocate $1.5 billion to work with state housing finance agencies to help address the foreclosure problems in the 5 states that have been the hardest hit by the aftermath of the burst of the housing bubble, as measured by housing prices. Eligible housing finance agencies may use the funding on a number of homeowner support programs, including programs for unemployed borrowers, for reducing the burden of negative equity, or for addressing challenges that arise from second liens. And while there are still significant risks, we are seeing some signs of emerging stability. Inventories continue to fall. House prices measured on a year-over-year basis are declining less rapidly, with some house price measures posting increases in recent months. Data released by the Mortgage Bankers Association on February 19th show that the 30-day delinquency rates on 1-to-4-unit residential mortgages fell in the first quarter, along with the number of new foreclosures started. Going forward, we recognize that there are still a number of challenges ahead. The permanent modification conversion campaign in December and January yielded valuable insights for program improvements. We've made a number of program changes to improve implementation. For example, at the end of January, Treasury released guidance which requires greater income documentation prior to beginning a trial modification. A simple and standard package of documents will be required prior to the servicer's evaluation of the borrower for a trial modification. We took these steps to speed up the process of conversions from trial to permanent modifications in the future. This new upfront documentation will be required for all new HAMP modifications that become effective after June 1st, although mortgage servicers may implement it sooner. And we continue to make more changes to improve implementation. One important improvement we are working on now is protections for homeowners to ensure that modification process treats borrowers fairly. Treasury anticipates releasing guidance soon, which will include a set of improved protections for homeowners in the HAMP mortgage modification program. Notably, the package will standardize outreach required for homeowners who fall behind in their mortgages and make an offer to include them in HAMP if they qualify. Additionally, we recognize that the foreclosure process is often confusing to homeowners already in distress, and we have been regularly reviewing guidelines around the process as part of our ongoing commitment to ensuring transparency and maximizing program effectiveness. HAMP has made great progress in its first year. We look forward to working with you to enhance the program's performance and to help keep American families in their homes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Caldwell, for your testimony. Last week, the administration announced a $1.5 billion program to help five states deal with the foreclosure crisis. But in designing that program, you excluded a number of hard-hit, long-suffering states such as Ohio, Pennsylvania, Texas, to name just a few. I have here a letter from a dozen members of the Ohio delegation. It's a letter that was circulated by myself and Congressman La Tourette, signed by Democrats and Republicans alike, demanding to know how you could possibly justify the exclusion of Ohio from any foreclosure initiative. And I ask for your answer now before this subcommittee.
Well, first, let me say, having testified in your district in Cleveland a few months ago, we really understand that there are residents suffering in the state of Ohio and in Cleveland in particular. And I think it's important to also set the context that HAMP and the programs announced last week are just one part of a broader administration's efforts to stabilize housing. And Ohio was the recipient of over $145 million in neighborhood stabilization grants, including $40 million in Cuyahoga County to deal with the very real foreclosure processes that were in place that before HAMP was even started. But I think stepping back to the announcement last week, as Representative Cummings said, negative equity is a severe problem and we had to start somewhere. And so we looked at those markets that had price declines of over 20% based on the peak to trough. And those markets are the markets that are going to be the target of this particular program.
Well, you know, I note that in looking at the states that you chose, all but one of the states in that new initiative are so-called Sun States. I know they've been hit hard, but they don't have a monopoly on the pain caused by the foreclosure crisis and predatory lending. What assurance can you give this committee that future administration initiatives will not similarly focus primarily on the Sun States to the exclusion of the hard-hit Midwestern states like Ohio?
Mr. Chairman, I think it's very important to understand that we have a broad array of initiatives, and while this particular one was focused on those states that had very high rapid price declines on purchase homes. Every day we are studying the problems facing homeownership in American families and continue to iterate our programs to address those needs.
When you make a major public unveiling of this kind of initiative, and Ohio, where we in particular in the Cleveland area, are acutely aware of the kind of help that other areas are getting, and we're standing there with massive areas that have been foreclosed, and some of which unfortunately have been abandoned. Your explanation, well, that's your explanation, is not really acceptable, because when you have these initiatives, you're still setting priorities. That's the message you're sending out. And you're going to have to do better. You're going to have to be able to come back to those of us who are in the Midwest and come up with, you know, some specific programs. Not, you know, we appreciate the neighborhood stabilization. That's fine. That is $145 million. Now you're talking about a $1.5 billion program you announced. We know the difference. And Ohio is, in our area, is the epicenter of the subprime meltdown. That's not the only problem, but I'm going to, I have one more question here. Banks and investors are holding millions of mortgages that are not worth anything near their paper value. The value of the houses that secure this debt has fallen to just a fraction. These bankers and investors have no hope to ever recoup their investment. But even after they got a taxpayer's bailout, these bankers and investors refused to write down the losses. So far, the government hasn't seemed willing to ask the bankers and investors to pay their fair share. HAMP hasn't resulted in many principal reductions. Now, the American people are wondering, is it the political influence of the very banks and investors that taxpayers bailed out that is causing you to avoid taking the necessary step of promoting principal reduction in the federal response to the foreclosure crisis? And when is the administration going to roll out a real program for getting principal reduction? Ms. Caldwell.
Mr. Chairman, we continue to think about principal reduction and the challenge facing real American families who wake up every day and realize that the value of the largest asset that they have is below what they owe in the house. So we have continued to study how we can make negative equity and principal reduction work better for HAMP. Currently, the program allows lenders to take principal reduction at any point in time in the modification, but one of the things that we've learned is most of the people who are underwater on their mortgage default after they've had an employment shock or income shock. And so this program was designed to target that affordability payment and keep them in their homes, recognizing that we continue to put pressure on the financial institutions to sign up for our second lien program so that we can have more principal write down on the second liens and continue to have more on the first.
I'm going to ask the committee to just indulge me in a quick follow-up. So what's stopping Treasury from writing down the principal of those loans and thereby giving the borrower a more affordable mortgage?
I think as we step back and look at HAMP, I think it's important to remember that when this program was started, we were looking at a crisis of epic proportion and a mortgage industry and a program that was largely voluntary, where there were mortgages, there were servicers, there were investors, and there were banks. And while many people look at the place where they write their check and they see the name of the bank and they think that's where their mortgage is, when their mortgage in fact has been sold to an investor. And one of the things that this program has done over the last year is brought together banks, borrowers, servicers, and investors to reshape a mortgage modification industry that last year was just about collecting payments. This is about keeping people in their homes with affordable payments. And I think the next stage is to look at how we can enhance the program to continue to address the challenge as we go forward.
Thank you, Mr. Caldwell. Chair recognizes Mr. Jordan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Caldwell, thank you again for being with us second time. In your testimony, you say in 1 year, HAMP has made significant progress. The numbers we have As of the end of last month, January 31st, 2010, HAMP had achieved just over 116,000 permanent mortgage modifications. Again, the stated goal being 3 to 4 million. So I guess my question is that really significant progress?
You know, Member Jordan, I think it's important as we step back and look at the program goals. The program was set out to provide an opportunity for 3 to 4 million homeowners to have a chance at a mortgage modification from program inception, which was a year ago, through the end of 2012. In its first year, we have 1 million homeowners in trial modifications. Well, and in those trial modifications, they are realizing close to a 40% reduction in their monthly payment.
Let me ask you this. Do you expect by 2012 to have 3 to 4 million homeowners in a permanent status? I mean, trial is one thing, but that's your term, trial modification. So trial is not there; it's trial. So do you expect it to get to the goal, the stated goal, right from the outset, 3 to 4 million? Do you expect to get to that number in 2 years, based on the fact only 116,000 are there today after 1 year?
Well, again, just to re-clarify the goal, I think. First, let me just say, we have never seen a mortgage crisis at this proportion. So it's too soon, 1 year in the program, to talk about what will happen 2 years out. But the program was designed to offer 3 to 4 million homeowners an opportunity for a mortgage modification, not a permanent modification, an opportunity. And 1 year in, we have 1 million homeowners saving $500 a month in a modification.
I mean, I come back, and I'm not. I'm sure you're working hard, and I just question this whole idea that the big federal government can do these kind of things. They come out with the promise, we're gonna do a stimulus plan. It's gonna keep unemployment 8%. We're gonna do a home modification program. We're gonna help 3 or 4 million people. And we've done 116,000 in 1 year, but we're gonna get to 4 million. We promise by 2012. I mean, do you? Yes or no? Do you think by 2012, 2 years from today, you will have 3 to 4 million people in a permanent modification plan?
I'll just say again, we're 1 year in to a mortgage modification program that is at a scale that has never been done in history, and it's really too soon to predict what will happen in 2012.
Okay. Let me move to the second one. Let's go to the transparency issue, if I could, Mr. Chairman, and if I run out of time, I'll wait till the second round. Let's go to, can we put up slide one, I think. This is the number of requests, and I guess my question is going to go to, they're going to be hard to see. Let me just cut right to the chase. Why did you decide to quit, if I understand, in July of last year, August, September, October, November, every month on your website, you were putting up the number of requests for financial information. And here the last 2 months, you've decided not to display that number. Is there a reason why you've decided not to put that number up? And if you had continued the practice you started with, what would the number be today?
Well, first of all, let me just emphasize that since its inception, the HAMP program has been focused on affordability, stability, and transparency. And so we are very committed to transparency of the program.
But you admit you're no longer putting that
correct.
Piece
the
of
number that
up.
You are referencing there was removed because it was confusing to the public. Just to clarify, the number is the number of requests for information that lenders send or servicers send to their entire portfolio of 60-day delinquent borrowers. It's not a measure that has anything to do with applications to HAMP or the Making Home Affordable program. That's just a measure of solicitations or inquiries on any modification. And many people were confusing it with HAMP. So we removed it because it was causing confusion in the report.
I mean, you've heard from taxpayers, you've heard from American citizens that it was confusing, or you just decided that it was confusing?
We heard from a number of people on conference calls, on Hill visits and press visits, but if it's an important number to the public, we'll put it back in. If to your question on what would it be today, it's about $3.5 million.
So it's up. You'll make a commitment to put that number back up there?
We will, but with more clarity that it relates to overall solicitations, not just HAMP.
I think that's a good thing. Transparency is transparency. The American people are smart people. They put Kucinich and Jordan in Congress. No, I'm kidding. They can figure it out. So I think that's something that should be up there. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Maryland, Mr. Cummings. You may proceed.
Thank you very much, Ms. Caldwell. What does the average trial modification, what's the savings for the borrower in a trial modification, and is that different than the savings in the permanent?
In terms of the data collection, we don't have exact data on the savings in a trial modification, but if there's been no change in the borrower's income, it should be the same. And so our population has a median savings of just over $500 per month.
So in other words, when they negotiate the trial, if their income doesn't change when they move to that date that would make them permanent, then you would assume it's pretty much the same.
Right, because it's based on affordability, on 31% debt to income.
The, it was reported in the press on Monday that Treasury plans to implement changes to HAMP, including a prohibition against lenders filing foreclosures while borrower is in the modification process. Are you familiar with that, right?
I'm familiar, yeah.
And I'm very pleased about that because I cannot tell you how many people at my event on Saturday and the two previous events that we had said that their lender went ahead with filing foreclosure while they were in the process. If you could, please run down other changes to HAMP that are being considered. Are there other things that are being considered?
Well, let me just first back up to the changes that you referenced that were mentioned in the paper earlier this week. Those have not been confirmed or approved. Those are changes under discussion. Mm-hmm. And as a program that has multiple stakeholders, those were changes that are being recommended, considered, and were being vetted with stakeholders and that were leaked to the press in advance of approval. And I think everyone in this room has experienced an advance leak. So that certainly is along the lines of what is being considered, but it is not yet finalized. In terms of...
Let me just ask you real quick, and what would be the process for finalizing those things that have been leaked to the press?
Full approval within Treasury.
All right. And
but let me go on to say, just in terms of future iterations to the program, every single day my office is looking at the homeowner experience in this program and what we can do to make it better. And so we have continually made adaptions, and we will continue to iterate until we're doing the service that we need to have to American homeowners.
Is there, tell me about the sense of urgency with regard to the one change that we just talked about with regard to not putting people out while they are trying to modify.
Well, let me just be clear at the front. The HAMP current guidelines prohibit a home from going to foreclosure sale while the homeowner is in HAMP trial modification. Mm-hmm. And so these changes are not, these changes are designed to enhance the communications so that homeowners have a clear understanding of their rights and that they know that their home cannot go to sale while they are in a HAMP modification.
I see.
That has been the case since the program was started.
And how important is it that you have cooperation of the lender or servicer in the HAMP program?
It's very important. HAMP is a voluntary program, but I think it's important. Once a servicer signs up for HAMP, they are under contract with U.S. Treasury, and they must perform. Mm-hmm. You know, when the program was launched a year ago, folks said, you'll never get servicers to sign up to modify mortgages. Within the first year, we went from zero servicers to 100 servicers, covering 90% of U.S. mortgages. And so while it is a voluntary program, once someone is in, they are under contract and they must comply with the regulations.
And that leads me to the question, you know, in my district, you heard what I said a little earlier. I mean, we work very hard to put lenders together with borrowers, and the number one complaint is that the borrower can't get a hold of anybody in the lender's office. I don't care who it is. I mean, we dealt with 25. We had them all in one place this weekend, past weekend, weekend before last. And so I'm trying to figure out where the problem is here. There's a disconnect. You follow me? And I'm sure this is happening all over the country. And that's the number one complaint. And I can get 1,000 people out on a Saturday morning in the snow. I'm serious. But they can't get a lender. And the reason why they come to me, and they shouldn't have to have a congressman to facilitate them. You know, so I'm just trying to figure out, you just said that you all are trying to make sure that you try to address all the issues, because I know you want to be as effective and efficient as you can be. And I just wondering if there's anything that we're missing here.
Well, let me first say that homeowner events like the one you held last weekend are very important. I was actually supposed to speak at the one when it was originally scheduled for the first part of February when we had the big snow. And so those are very important. I happened to be at a similar event that our office was hosting in Houston, Texas, and that opportunity for face-to-face connection with the servicer is important. But I think it's important to remember, a year ago, servicers were just in the business of collecting checks, making phone calls, and foreclosing. And as part of this crisis, they have had to fundamentally reshape their operations to handle homeowners in crisis, to follow the rules of a government program, to shift modifications from those that used to increase a homeowner's payment to those that are long-term and sustainable. And so as they have ramped up, there have been some implementation challenges. Some signed up before they were ready. Some are doing better than others. And part of our commitment to transparency is publishing a monthly servicer performance report so that we can judge who's getting the job done and who's not.
Thank you. The gentleman's time has expired. Chair recognizes Ms. Kaptur.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding these hearings. Welcome, Ms. Caldwell. Could you please, for the record, state at which institution you first began as a mortgage loan officer?
I have never been a mortgage loan officer, so.
Thank you. Have you ever in your prior positions handled the assets and liabilities of a financial institution and how they actually account for the value of real estate?
Yes, ma'am, I have.
Okay, and for which institution was that?
With Bank of America.
Bank of America. Have you ever been a part of the resolution of an institution or any instrumentality of Bank of America as they tried to work out on the books of that institution troubled real estate loans?
Yes.
And have you been a part of an effort to mark the value of those assets to market for those institutions on their own books?
Certain asset classes are required to mark to market and certain aren't. So it really depends on the accounting rules with the various assets that
okay.
I've been a part of.
I am trying to understand. Now, you're over at the Treasury Building, right?
Correct.
You're over at the Treasury Building. I have found this whole approach to dealing with the housing market foreign to anything I have ever known. And in a way, I think you have a job that's doomed to failure. And I don't understand why the last administration and this administration are using these means to deal with the real estate implosion in this country. So some of my questions And I asked Secretary Geithner yesterday to come and see the people over in the administration who are involved in these programs. Because I can't figure out if Treasury has been selected to try to dig out of this avalanche of troubled loans, because the system can't find the loans on the books of the institutions that originated them and then sold them upstream. Or if they're doing it for some other reason that I don't really understand. But what's been happening in communities like my own, foreclosures are going up and not down. Home values are going down, not up. Credit is frozen across this country because the banking system doesn't have confidence that the regulators or those in charge of regulating the financial institutions of this country have any consistency in what they are doing. And so this recent decision by TARP, the group that decided that Merrill Lynch would be merged but Lehman would go down, now the same instrumentality has decided that five states are going to get TARP money to deal with home foreclosures, but 45 other states aren't. And I can tell you I represent a district where the unemployment rate in the four counties I represent are higher than the unemployment rates of the states of Nevada and California and Florida and the other states that were selected. So it's really, I'm thinking, So Treasury now picked five, but it didn't pick troubled areas of the other four. It makes no sense to me. And I'm wondering why the FDIC and the SEC aren't being used to deal with home value in a normal manner so that the books are resolved to the institutions that have held these loans, but rather all this is being thrust at you at Treasury, which is not a housing agency. Never has been. It's a bonding agency. It sells bonds. It collects taxes. That's what it does. The real housing knowledge is inside of HUD. It's inside of FDIC because those loans are on the books of the institutions that made the loans, and it's over at the SEC. So we're not resolving the in fact, what we're doing, what's happening is the approach is pro-cyclical. What's being done to date is driving us into further recession, less lending, and more delinquencies. And I can tell you, I mean, I'm not the only one up here. In the HAMP program, it's not working. As hard as you try, they've given you an impossible job. And to resolve what's wrong with the housing market, I asked Secretary Geithner for a meeting, and I guess he's agreed to do it. He's not a houser. Hasn't been involved in real estate. This is really complicated. We need to use the proper regulatory instruments, and we're not using them. And it's beyond me why, unless we can't find the loans. Unless they're missing somewhere, and we can't, and I don't believe that. I think that we can resolve them on the books. So I guess rather than giving you all the troubled real estate loans in the country, what I think should be happening is every single institution that made those loans, we should be resolving and taking those losses, writing down the principal on those assets and liabilities on the books of those banks. That's what bank examiners do. That's what the FDIC does. So my fundamental question is, why aren't we doing that?
The witness will have time to give a brief response.
Let me just say for the HAMP program, which is what my team does every single day, when you look at the mortgage structure that we have today, over 90% of the mortgages in the United States are serviced by HAMP eligible servicers. And that happened from within its first year of operations. We have 1 million homeowners that are saving 40% a month on their mortgage payment. And this is only one piece of the administration's overall housing solution. When you think about interest rates, you think about refinance, think about the purchase of mortgage-backed securities, so there are no, and you think about HUD neighborhood stabilization funds, there are a number of agencies working together to address what is the largest housing crisis of our time.
We're going to go to Mr. Tierney, Massachusetts. Then we're going to have one more round, Ms. Caldwell, because myself, Mr. Jordan, and perhaps other members have some additional questions. What about Ohio? Tell me, what are you going to do? What are you going to do for Cleveland? You got to do more. What are you going to do?
Well, I think it's important to keep in mind that right now there are over 22,000 homeowners in trial modifications in the state of Ohio, and our job, number one, is to get those homeowners into permanent modifications. And so we are focused on that every day.
Don't you have about 19.4% of people in Ohio that are already underwater?
I don't know the underwater statistics for Ohio, but we continue to look at everything we can do in Ohio and across the United States to keep homes, those people in their homes.
Okay. It's not good enough. You're going to have to do more. We'll be in conversation about these things, but I'm not satisfied. Listen to what Mr. Rokakis has to say in the next panel, because he has some of the granular details about what's going on in Cleveland, Cuyahoga County. I'm sure you're doing your best, but this is a wake-up call, and consider it a friendly wake-up call. I'm concerned that you haven't done enough to pressure the loan servicers and investors, and all the effort put into this program will not make a meaningful difference for the large number of homeowners in America who need help. That is the underwater borrowers, the borrowers who do not get modifications because of conflict of interest by the lenders owning both the first and second mortgages. Four biggest banks control two-thirds of all loan servicing. What is Treasury doing to address this problem?
We're doing a number of things. I think and transparency is key here. Beginning in November, with our data published in December, we published servicer-by-servicer performance reports. And that is a big motivating tool in getting those modifications made and converted. In addition, we've hired Making Home Affordable Compliance. It's a separate unit of Freddie Mac that goes in and inspects all of the major servicers to make sure that they are appropriately soliciting homeowners that are eligible for HAMP modifications and that they're doing it in the appropriate way. And third, we run a call center in partnership with Hope Now and NeighborWorks to make sure that we are providing homeowners across America an opportunity to get help on their loan and get referred to a counselor where needed.
I've looked at your testimony, all of it, and it touts the accomplishments of the HAMP program, but it's hard not to conclude that the administration has created a system that's all carrot, no stick. All along, we've heard reports of the poor treatment of borrowers by loan servicers. Counselors in foreclosure prevention programs across the country relayed their stories through the media. And we hear that one of the most common reasons loan servicers deny borrowers modifications is for the alleged reason that the borrower's hardship isn't permanent. What can you tell borrowers who are getting this kind of treatment from loan servicers?
You know, our office and the call centers speak with borrowers every day on the phone. We have been out to 40 cities across the United States, or we've made a commitment to go to 40 cities. We've been to 22 to meet with homeowners in person. We regularly go out into the district offices because we want to hear about the experience that people are having. This program was designed with the borrower at the forefront. And every day, this office takes seriously the experience of homeowners across America.
How do people get a hold of you and indicate their experience? You had a website? Do you want them to go to?
We have a website. And
what is that address?
It is makinghomeaffordable.gov. And we have a phone number, which I'll have to provide to you. But I know the last four digits are H-E-L-P.
We don't want that to be wrong. Okay, well, we will make sure that we work with you in circulating that information. Now, one big complaint among borrower advocates is that loan servicers can proceed with a foreclosure while the borrower is still being evaluated for and is in a trial period for a loan modification. What are you doing to change that?
Well, again, as I said earlier, I think it's important to understand that HAMP guidelines have always said that a home may not be sold, go to foreclosure sale while a borrower is in HAMP. Foreclosure laws do differ across states, and so there are some states where there may be borrowers or homeowners in a foreclosure process, albeit not a sale, while undergoing HAMP. And so one of the things that we are very committed to doing is making sure that homeowners understand that process, that servicers understand their responsibility in the process, and that there are no situations where a homeowner goes through an avoidable foreclosure.
My time, thank you. My time has expired, but I'm going to ask you to be open to submissions by members of this subcommittee of follow-up questions that we may have. I have a follow-up question about underperforming servicers, but I'll put it in writing. We're going to move along with this and get to the second panel after other members have had a chance to ask a second round of questions. Chair recognizes Mr. Jordan. You may proceed for 5 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Caldwell, let me get back to this transparency concern of, you know, for the $75 billion, potentially $75 billion program. The Special Inspector General for TARP has made a recommendation that Treasury should require the servicer to compare the income, I mean, it's straight out of their book, compare the income report on the mortgage modification application with the income reported on the original loan. They list in their latest report that this recommendation has not been implemented. Why hasn't it? I mean, that seems to me that we're looking at potential fraud, just a good government type of thing that could happen. Why haven't you done that? Why haven't you required that?
The HAMP program is a modification program, not an origination program. And so this program is designed to prevent avoidable foreclosures. So the focus is on what is the homeowner's current hardship and the documentation of the income that they have today to make sure they can keep an affordable payment.
If I could, Ms. Caldwell, don't you think in light of all that took place a few years ago when we talked about some of these loans that were made and there was maybe no documentation, not there was potential fraud, don't you think it makes sense, you as a professional who served in this industry, don't you think it makes sense to look at that and the guy who's supposed to inspect, the Inspector General of the program, is supposed to watch out for the billions of taxpayer dollars potentially at risk, I mean, why wouldn't you do it? The Inspector General's telling you to do it. It makes sense. It was part of what started us in this mess to begin with a few years back. Seems to me that would be something, oh yeah, no brainer, let's do it.
Our focus right now in the HAMP program is getting the documentation in from the borrowers currently in trial modifications on their income and the hardships that they're facing today so that they can get converted to permanent modification.
Do you intend to comply
not
with,
on
do
whatever
you intend at any point over the next 2 years
ago,
as you're trying to get to this goal of 3 million, 4 million, and you've only done 116,000, do you intend at any point over the next 2 years to do what the Inspector General has asked you to do?
We're always looking at ways to iterate and improve the program to provide a better experience for the borrower and for the taxpayer. Right now, we're focused on the conversion from trial modifications to permanent modifications, but we continue to look at the program.
Is that a no? You're not going to do what the Inspector General suggests you do?
It is I can't say today, 1 year into the program, what we're going to do between now and 2012. But I can commit that we continue to review it.
What's the qualification rate? 1 million people have applied and are in trial modification. What 116? What do you know the percentage of folks? And do you anticipate those who are still in trial modification? What percentage of those are going to make it into permanent modification of their loan? Are the vast majority going to continue to be rejected? That's the history. You anticipate that being the case as we move forward.
In terms of a conversion ratio, it is too early to predict what the long-term conversion ratio can be. The one prediction that I would be prepared to say is that when documentation is required up front, the conversion ratio will be higher because the documentation collection has been a challenge. I do think it's important to just again emphasize that the program isn't designed to provide 3 to 4 million an opportunity for a modification, not a commitment to modify three to four million mortgages.
Well, let me ask, it looks like a high number are going to be in trial and not make it to the permanent. With that fact in mind, if homeowners who get trial modifications but don't qualify for permanent ones end up defaulting on their mortgages, wouldn't it have been better for them to pursue some other type of approach, some other type of remedy for the difficult economic situation they're in?
Well, I think it's important to remember that HAMP is a pay-for-success program, so incentives do not get paid to the servicer until the loan becomes permanent, and then there are incentive payments as the loan stays current over a five-year period. So to the extent that a loan does redefault, taxpayer money is not paid to support that loan. In terms of keeping homeowners in their home and avoiding foreclosure for a longer period of time, I think that is a good outcome.
Let me ask one final question, if I could, Mr. Chairman. This is from a week or two ago, Wall Street Journal piece on the program, the date, February 9th. Former head of Freddie Mac, David Moffitt, says he and others warned administration officials that the loan modification goals were unrealistic, that borrowers whose homes weren't worth what they owed were unlikely to take part, and that many participants would be likely to redefault within months. Quote, they didn't want our views, Mr. Moffitt says. Looks like he was somewhat, you know, visionary or prophetic on his statement there. Is that statement accurate in your mind, Ms. Caldwell? And were, in fact, you, those of you at Treasury, I don't know if you were there quite yet, but do you know if folks at Treasury were warned about, you know, got this warning that Mr. Moffitt states in the article?
You're correct. I joined Treasury in November of 2009, so I can't speak to what people were thinking at Treasury, but what I can say is that in the program today, we have over two-thirds of homeowners current on their mortgage, and we've never had anything at this scale, so we don't have historical data to fall back on, but what we do know in loss mitigation prior to this crisis, close to 45 to 50% redefaulted. So we are outperforming in terms of prior history.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, you know, if you have another hearing, I don't know if you're going to, but if you do, we may want to get Mr. Moffitt.
I have a feeling that we're about to become good friends here.
Mr. Moffitt may be someone we want in front of the committee. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Chair recognizes Mr. Cummings.
I thought Mr. Tierney was...
Mr. Tierney waived on the last round, but if
I
would be happy to begin with Mr. Tierney.
I'll yield to Mr. Tierney.
Okay, Mr. Tierney.
Thank you. I apologize for missing your remarks in the early part of the questioning, so some of this might be repetitive. I'm sure it probably is, but as long as we're here. Can you tell me why the administration hasn't considered any sort of principal reduction program or whether it might do that in the future and what it would look like if it did?
Right now, HAMP currently allows for principal write-down at any point in time in the mortgage modification. I'll also say that...
It allows for it, but it doesn't naturally move in that direction.
And the administration has been studying ways to look at principal write-down as part of a mortgage modification. But one of the things that we have learned is that the bulk of the people who are underwater in their mortgage are currently paying. And so we're always examining that in the lens of cost to the taxpayer, moral hazard, and keeping the program running. And so with that in mind, this program was designed for affordability to make sure that people could stay in their homes with a payment they could afford.
Now, when you're looking at this new plan to divert about $1.5 billion in TARP funds to just five states, will there be a change in attitude with respect to that, since it's TARP money and a lot of those banks that may be involved actually took taxpayer money, will be requiring a little bit more from them in terms of principal forgiveness?
Right now we're looking at this program announced last week. We're trying to get it up and launched and learn from what the local housing finance agencies are doing. And like with everything else that we've done with this kind of crisis that is something we've never seen before in our history, we want to take the lessons that we learn from this and all of our other housing initiatives and try to make our program better.
So that's a no, right?
It's a, we, it's a too early to tell. We are all learning through this together as we go along.
But you've not done it in the past, so there's nothing to learn from the past about doing it because you haven't done it. So I'm asking whether or not you're going to take some consideration and maybe some emphasis on trying something new, particularly where some of the banks involved have already taken the taxpayers' money, and now, say in some instances where it's appropriate, we're going to make a conscious effort to aggressively go and get principal reduction, see if we can get these people to stay in their homes and have these banks do something responsible. Is that not something you're going to go aggressively after?
Our office has been aggressively considering proposals from on all areas that we can do to address the foreclosure crisis in this country and prevent affordable foreclosures. But as I said earlier, we have to do that with the lens of affordability, stability, and transparency, and we have to think about it with the taxpayer dollars.
All right. Seems to me you have an aversion to that, but we'll see how it develops. Yield back to Mr. Cummings.
Just one real quick question.
Mr. Cummings.
He just yielded back to me, Mr. Chairman. One of the disturbing things that you said that upsets me tremendously, and I just checked with my office to make sure, there are people, I don't care whether it's in law or not, there are people who are being foreclosed upon, whether it's in the law or not. And we can give you name, dates, and serial numbers. And some kind of way, we got to get to that. I mean, apparently there is no enforcement mechanism. That's number one. Number two, in the HAMP program, now, by the way. Number two, you seem to make a big deal out of this thing of listing the servicers and how many, what they did. I don't know. I'm trying to figure out how do you see that as an incentive? Is there any data that shows that they get? They get overjoyed or something when they see their name listed and there are a lot of, you know, they've done a lot of these modifications because it doesn't seem to be working.
You know, public pressure and transparency is one tool, but I think it's also important to remember that HAMP is a pay-for-success program. So if modifications don't convert, servicers don't get paid. And so you get paid for success. In addition, if there are modifications that have not been done appropriately, then under the contract, Treasury can go back and take back that incentive.
So if we have situations where people are doing that, the thing about with the foreclosures while they're working out the HAMP program, we should get that information to you?
Absolutely. If there are cases where you have servicers in your market that have violated the guidelines under HAMP, we want to know about that.
And what will you do?
We then turn that to our compliance agent. We have a compliance committee. They review it. They determine the facts. And then there's a recommendation made about remedies.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, gentlemen. Chair recognizes the ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Issa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ranking Member Jordan had asked you about transparency pursuant to the special IG for the TARP. And I don't think he got a satisfactory answer. Do you believe that the American people deserve 100% transparency on your actions and your progress?
I do. As we said, this program has been designed to look at affordability, stability, and transparency.
Okay. Well, going through the transparency, since you've only done 116,000 permanent loan modifications, or 3% of your goal, and we are well into your time horizon, how can we see in a transparent way your progress so that we can determine whether or not you have any hope of, in a qualified way, in an effective way, achieving anywhere close to your original goal, or if you're not, to take back a substantial portion of the $75 billion, because ultimately, if you're not going to get close to the 3 to 4 million in permanent loan modifications, shouldn't we encourage the President to reallocate that money?
Let me answer. I think your first question was about the 3 to 4 million, and it's important to again stress, as I did for Member Jordan, that it was not designed to provide a commitment of modifications to 3 to 4 million people, but rather 3 to 4 million homeowners an opportunity for a permanent modification.
Well, let's
so
go back
through.
How much of the $75 billion have you used with 116,000 permanent loan modifications?
I don't have the exact answer to that, but it's important
to
remember that
if we're going to have transparency, then where can I go and find out how much you spent in somewhere close to real time? See, this committee wants transparency. We demand it. We're demanding it of the banks. We're demanding of all kinds of institutions we didn't before. If you don't have, if you come before the Congress in a scheduled hearing and you don't have the answer to a question of how much you've spent, then I would like, for the record, a place where my staff can go on a daily basis from here forward, click on a public site, or if there is a reason for it not to be public, and a less than public site, and get that answer. Can you make that commitment to me today that you will bring us back that answer?
I can bring you back an answer on the amount spent, yes. But I will again say, because the program only pays for permanent modifications, it has not spent much.
Okay. Do you, by the way, receive a tally on a daily basis or as requested immediately of how much has been spent? Is that a question you ask and get answered periodically?
It's a question asked periodically, but not daily.
But when you ask it, how long before you get an answer usually?
It's hard to say.
Well, I mean, just give me a one example. It'd be fine. A day, a week, a month, an hour?
Within the time requested, but that it is published.
What? You're telling me that this is published, that my staff could go during this meeting and get that information?
From the TARP funds, yes. There's financial statements for the TARP.
Well, the special IG basically said, no, there isn't. That's one of the problems, is the accountability and transparency in his report, which is rather lengthy, comes up with a not so good. You know, this is not a B-plus exercise. This is a D-minus exercise in many of the things that he said. Well, let me move on to just maybe one or two other questions. You're now well enough into it with 116,000 modifications. Let me go to a question that was asked before, maybe to set a stage. How many banks did we give money to in the TARP? Not in your program, in the TARP overall. Did we give money to anybody or did we loan money to them?
In the TARP?
Yes. We loaned money to the banks, right? They paid back with interest, and most have exited. The largest banks have exited.
When
you're going to the banks asking them to do loan modifications, to basically forgive, in some cases, substantial portions of principal, you haven't given them any money. The only money is the money that you... that you in fact are standing there out of your $75 billion. Isn't that correct? That their inducement is whatever you bring with your $75 billion in funds. Is that right?
Well, and enforcement under a contract that they've signed.
If they choose to participate with you.
Of which over 100 servicers have, covering 90% of the mortgages.
Okay.
And the TARP banks servicers have all signed up.
But those are those who chose. I just wanted to make clear that the gentleman on the other side was implying we gave money and therefore they had an obligation. But the only people that have an obligation are those who signed up for this program, and you're giving them money from the $75 billion. Is that right?
For their performance under the contract, correct.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
General's time has expired. Chair recognizes Ms. Kaptur.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I would appreciate if Ms. Caldwell would answer. Do you possess a degree in finance or banking or accounting?
Finance.
Accounting science?
No.
Your degree is in science?
A degree is in finance.
Finance. Thank you very much. According to information that I have, in Ohio, in the past year, 2,529 homeowners got what are called permanent modifications. That doesn't mean that anything actually happened. It just means they went through some process that got them to some point. Of the program that you have responsibility for, the HAMP program, what percent are of those individuals that have come to the government of the United States through your program have actually been resolved? All those servicers you said that work or are signed up for your program, what percent? Is it 5%, 3%? What's the number for the country?
I'm sorry, can you ask the percentage of what? I didn't understand your question.
Of the home loans that have actually been refinanced and resolved, where the people were able to stay in their homes, either through principal reduction, reworking of the mortgage loan, whatever. What percent in your program?
In our program, we, at this point in time, because we have homeowners in a temporary review, at the end of December, we put homeowners in a trial modification to do one more review so that we could make sure that those, that they understood what documents needed to be in and that they had a chance to become current. So therefore, we have not had very many people declined in order to, so there's, that's not a number we can give you.
You cannot.
Everyone that's still in a trial, unless their property is ineligible for HAMP or they have withdrawn from HAMP, they've not been able to be declined.
Well, according to the numbers that I have, Ohio had about 90,000 homeowners who were foreclosed on in the last year, and of that number, we have 2,529, a very small percentage, who got permanent modification to their mortgage. But when you really probe beneath the surface, that permanent modification doesn't necessarily mean that they remained in their home, because something can change, because it's in the program and something else can happen to it. So my point is, it's a very, very small number of people who've gotten any home security out of this program after 1 year in Ohio. Maybe it's different in other states, I don't really know. But certainly in Ohio, we don't see any kind of real bounce from this program. If it's all right, I would like to state some of the difficulties that we are having in Ohio. The servicers really aren't serious. Participation is voluntary. They can fiddle around with a loan for months. There's no strong arm of FDIC in there or the SEC working with the institutions, which goes back to my original question. It's very curious to me that these mortgage loans are being worked out at Treasury. That's never been the housing. Treasury certainly doesn't do servicing. I mean, it's just an odd place in the government of the United States to conduct these activities. But let me just state for the record a couple of real problems here. The 31% threshold that is used in the program that you manage is unrealistic in regions that have traditional affordable housing stock like Ohio. We didn't have the big bump up like Arizona, and I'm sort of offended. California, you know, all these Arizona, all these places that had hyperinflation, they get attention, and yet, you know, the heartland again gets run over with a Mack truck because the people in our area were paying less than 31% of their income for their mortgage. And the modification process actually increases their payment and exceeds the 31% threshold. So it really works. Again, it's just another, it becomes a pro-cyclical means of denying people the ability to work out their mortgage. As you know, there's a huge lack of coordination between the legal, the loss mitigation, the collection, and the homeownership offices of lenders or servicers. Total confusion, loss of documents, and I'll tell you, one of the worst companies is Bank of America. We get so many complaints about Bank of America, your former firm, and documents are constantly being lost, and I just wonder what you think, Ms. Caldwell.
The gentlelady's time. I'd ask unanimous consent that the gentlelady have an additional minute.
The gentlelady's time has expired. There's a unanimous consent to give her another minute. You can ask, if you could ask a question, we'll ask Ms. Caldwell to respond.
I thank the chairman and I thank the ranking member. I want to know what you can do to get the servicers to really do their job.
No, I think it's, again, as I stated earlier, this program went from startup to 1 million homeowners in trial in a year and zero to 100 servicers in the first year. And we have acknowledged there have been implementation challenges as this industry fundamentally restructured. And so we continue every day to learn from what's happened in the prior month to make improvements. Now, when you talk about permanent modifications, we started the month of December with 31,000 modifications. In fact, when I testified for the Chairman and the Ranking Member, a few months ago, we had 31,000 modifications. Through daily efforts with the servicers, setting goals, improving processes, we now have 116,000 modifications. That's in 2 months, with another 76,000 out the door waiting signatures.
Could you define what modification really means?
Permanent modifications, where a homeowner has been through a trial and converted to permanent modification. So that's been a doubling of pace in the last 60 days, and that's a result of just growing into the system and learning from the startup process.
If there's a third round, Mr. Chairman, I'll continue my questioning.
The gentlelady's time has expired. This is the end of the second round of questions. We've got three panels, and we're going to need to move on. To my colleague, Congresswoman Kaptur, Ms. Caldwell has consented to answering any questions that can be put in writing, and we'll make those, if we get a timely response, part of this. As has been pointed out by my colleague, Sig Tarp has said that the American people deserve better. Ms. Caldwell, I hope that you will agree. Thank you very much for being here. We're going to ask to our second panel to come up. I want to thank all my colleagues, Mr. Tierney, Mr. Cummings, Ms. Kaptur, Mr. Jordan, Turner, Mr. Issa, for being here. Second panel, would you step forward, and we will move to swear in the witnesses. While you're coming forward, I'm going to do some introductions. Second panel consists of Mr. Bill Shield. Mr. Shield is a journalist and investigative reporter for WJW Fox Channel 8 in Cleveland, Ohio, where he's won numerous regional Emmys, as well as the Edward R. Murrow Award for his reporting. Mr. Jim Rokakis has served as the Cuyahoga County Treasurer since 1997. Under his leadership, the office took an early role in combating the foreclosure crisis, particularly in regard to abandoned properties and the creation of a county land bank. He helped create and oversee the county's Don't Borrow Trouble Mortgage Foreclosure Prevention Program. Finally, Ms. Patricia Stringfield is a resident of Washington, D.C. and has lived here all of her life. She's been a homeowner since 1988 and has sought a modification of her home mortgage under the HAMP program. So, I'm going to ask the witnesses to stand. It is the policy of our committee to swear in all witnesses. And I would ask if you would rise and raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you. Let the record reflect that each of the witnesses have answered in the affirmative. Now, I'm going to ask that each of the witnesses give a brief summary of their testimony. What you'd like to keep in mind that your testimony should be no more than 5 minutes in duration. Your complete written statements will be included in the hearing record. Now, Mr. Shields, our first witness, and his testimony is in the form of an excerpt from an investigative report he produced for Fox Cleveland's I-Team. If we can play the video, and if you have any comment over the video, that would be fine, Mr. Shield. Can we, staff, you want to? You're working on it?
So what we did here is, these are some pictures in New Orleans, and these are some pictures in Cleveland, interspersed, and we're asking you, can you tell the difference? That's part of Hurricane Katrina. Some of this video is Cleveland. They're interspersing with New Orleans. And the point of the story was to be that you can't really tell which is which. That is Cleveland right there, those four homes in a row that are vacant. Tony Brancatelli is a councilman. That is Slavic Village and what it looked like about 30 years ago, a middle-class neighborhood just south of the city. This is a sense of what Slavic Village looks like today. These are pipes inside a house that's more than a century old that had gas lamps in it, plumbing in the back. Obviously, another shot of Katrina as we go back to New Orleans. Councilman Brancatelli showing us that it was the perfect storm in Cleveland that led to this housing crisis in many ways. These homes have outlasted their usefulness. The plumbing is in the back because they predate indoor plumbing, and the plumbing was attached later. And they're often flipped and sold and paint slapped on them, and then they're resold, and we have the problem again and again and again, which is what I'm saying, hopefully better than you're hearing it from me now, right there. And then the question is, are there ways that we can, you know, improve the region, and are there ways that we can make things better? This is a pair of teachers. They are talking about the problems in their neighborhood and how they want things to get better and how they want to be part of the solution and how they want to purchase this old abandoned home. And they had some problems making the purchase, some problems, quite frankly, dealing with the governmental agency that I think have been resolved now. But this is on the west side of Cleveland. This is a totally separate area from Slavic Village. We're focusing only on one house here because it's next door to the new home that they invested in, and they're trying to make the city work just in their neighborhood, but it's very hard to do with that eyesore next to them that they want to be part of the solution for bringing it down and putting a park, quite frankly, on that corner, which is not far from Lake Erie. It's a beautiful piece of property. And they're explaining that they're just frustrated by what's happened in the neighborhood that they've reinvested in, and that they want the neighborhood to get better, and they want the government, however it should, or to help them. That's their house on the right. That's the property that's on the corner. Behind them is a view of the lake. Councilman Brancatelli in Slavic Village indicating that, you know, that the local officials need help making this happen. Talking about all the different for sale areas around Slavic Village. We had a lot of copper stolen from all of these homes when copper prices were high. This is what some people think the solution is, actually, which is to knock down these homes that no longer have value, give them to the neighboring homeowners, plant trees, do something other than having boarded up drug houses in the areas. If you look up top there, that's where kerosene came in, predating electricity. This is where all the copper was stolen when copper prices were high from these abandoned homes, and people stole them for money. The tragedy in these neighborhoods and parts is a lot of older people still live in the area who can't leave. We're talking here, I think, about the infrastructure that still exists in these neighborhoods, banks, gas stations. The neighborhoods have not yet died. There still is the infrastructure that creates neighborhood there, if something can be done about what you're seeing behind me here. And I want to say these are not isolated neighborhoods. You could go to 12 neighborhoods in Cleveland and get this. This is explaining a process how money flowed into a government account and how that was part of the problem. Again, I think that's been addressed. And I think that's the portion we're showing, Mr. Chair.
I want to thank you, Mr. Scheel, for being here and for the investigative report. We're going to go to questions to you when we finish with the other witnesses. But thank you for that presentation. Chair recognizes Mr. Rokakis. You may proceed for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to ask the gentleman from IT to have those slides ready. I hope they're up. I'm the treasurer of Cuyahoga County. While the collapse of the real estate market has shifted the focus away from Cuyahoga County in Ohio, it's important to note, as you pointed out, Mr. Chairman, that no other community has suffered the cumulative impact worse than Cuyahoga County, Ohio. Cuyahoga County was first nationally from 2000 to 2006. When the real estate bubble burst at the end of 2006, and this dubious distinction, worst in the country, moved to other communities in places like California, Nevada, Arizona, and Florida, this crisis did not go away in communities like Cleveland or in states like Ohio. In 2006, the last year Cuyahoga County led the country in foreclosures, we had 13,600 foreclosures. We had over 14,000 in 2007, when we were no longer first, almost 14,000 in 2008, 14,000 in 2009, and we're expecting a similar number in 2010. A quick review of the county foreclosure maps, I don't know if you have them there, We have a glitch with ITM, so every time I attempt to do this, Mr. Chairman, I botch it. But a quick review of these maps would show you that the foreclosures, while they have decreased just a bit in Cleveland, the core city, in part because there's nothing left, they've really picked up in the inner ring and the outer ring suburbs. And if you move the progression through to 2009, you'll see those shifting dark shades result are density in foreclosures. They have moved from the core city 2007, 2008, 2009, the last year, and as you see, this cancer has spread out. Even more troubling is evidence that tens of thousands of loans that could be foreclosed are backed up and are at least 90 days late, as evidenced by this next progression of slides. You will see, and these slides clearly demonstrate, that delinquent loans are backed up in the foreclosure queue. Look at the 90-day slide to the right. Just keep progressing forward. What you'll see that there are tens of thousands of loans in Ohio that are now 90 day late. They've backed up in this foreclosure dam, and when they burst, and they will burst, it will add to the misery and despair we feel in our communities. This crisis has resulted in at least 35,000 vacant properties, 18 to 20,000 properties awaiting demolition in Cuyahoga County, and a population loss in Cuyahoga County that is second only to Orleans Parish in Louisiana, and we know why they are first. Cleveland, which had 473,000 residents in 2000 census, it has been estimated may drop to as few as 325,000 residents in the 2010 census, a 30% loss of population in just 10 years. Property values have plummeted throughout the county. Half of all sales in Cleveland last year, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, were sheriff's sales. The consequences on governmental budgets, especially public schools, which rely heavily on property taxes, will be felt for the next generation. In one recent study, if you could put that up, it's the study of negative equity. Ohio shows up as negative ninth in the country, but Congressman Kaptur made a very good point. We never experienced the run-up of real estate prices that many of the other states ahead of us on that list experienced. So our losses were more significant as they took away real value, not one driven by real estate speculation. We are talking here today about the disappointment with the HAMP program. Those reasons have been well reported, but HAMP has been especially ineffective in Ohio, as you see on that chart, members of the committee, as only three states have experienced a lower percentage of loan modifications than Ohio. For all these reasons, we were stunned to see the rollout of the plan last week by the Obama administration to use $1.5 billion in TARP funds to assist California, Nevada, Florida, Arizona, and Michigan. How can a state at the epicenter of this crisis for so long be ignored once again? How is that possible? The only effective remedy in our experience that works in this fight is foreclosure counseling. And to Congresswoman Cummings' point, I am not talking about the 1-800 call-in numbers to call-in centers. I'm talking about the intense face-to-face personal counseling where trained foreclosure counselors work with homeowners in distress and stay with them as they do loan modifications. A program we established in Cuyahoga County, our Don't Borrow Trouble campaign, is one of the most effective in the country. It takes people who call 211 and refers them to four trained counseling agencies where people sit down face-to-face, again, not over a long-distance phone number. Homeowners are then assigned to foreclosure counselors who meet with them, gather financial information, assess the situation, and proceed to work on their loan modifications with the servicer. Our success rate in 2008 was 56% of those who came in and sat down with their counselors has their loans modified. Now, some of these mortgages are beyond repair, but our success rate when a homeowner calls us again, as I said, we think is the best in the country, which brings me for my major reason for being here today, which is to plead with you, Mr. Chairman, and members of this committee, to restore funding to the National Foreclosure Mitigation Counseling Program, or NFMC, which is an arm of Neighborhood Works. Reductions at the federal level to this program have resulted in direct funding cuts to counseling agencies in Cuyahoga County and Ohio, organizations like ESOP, a nationally regarded community group that is, I think, the most effective housing counseling agency in Ohio. Last year, ESOP received $1.7 million in funding through NFMC. Because of reductions in funding, their allocation this year is only $568,000. They are laying off counselors, housing counselors, beginning Monday. Other organizations throughout the state are doing the same. Last year, ESOP counseled 8,000 families statewide. This year, as a result of the cuts, they expect to only be able to counsel 3,000 families. The chart I'd like to show you there, the last chart, graphically demonstrates federal policy is moving in the wrong direction. Delinquencies are moving up, but foreclosure counseling dollars are moving down. It is incomprehensible, nonsensical, and wrong. Time is running out. if only 0.2% of the amount allocated to each of those states, assume an even split, $300 million, if 0.2% of the monies allocated to those five states last Friday were allocated to these programs, we could keep these housing counselors on and continue what I think is the good fight and the only effective program that has worked thus far. Thank you, Congressman Kucinich, and members of the committee for listening to me today.
Mr. Rokakis, your testimony is very important, and I have just had staff take a copy of it over to Ms. Caldwell, who, unlike most people who testify in front of our committees, actually stays to hear what other people have to say. And I always appreciate that about you, Ms. Caldwell, but I make sure that Mr. Rokakis' testimony, if you look at the maps, you see the progression, I think it'd be helpful, and you'll understand why those of us in Cleveland-Cauga County and in the state are so concerned when we get a signal from the administration that perhaps it's not looking closely enough at what's happening in our community. I also want you to know, Mr. Rokakis, that this afternoon we'll have a copy of your testimony sent over to the Treasury Secretary as well. We believe this is a very important message. Another important message about to be delivered to us from someone who lives in the neighborhoods of Washington, D.C. And Ms. Stringfield, would you be so kind as to proceed with your testimony and share with this subcommittee what your experience has been? I thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Patricia Stringfield. I am a resident of the District of Columbia, and I come here today to tell you a story of my situation. I'm a single mother who has worked my entire life to make sure that my son and I are taken care of and that he had a stable home environment. In 1988, I purchased my home from my mother. I did so because I had grown up in the neighborhood, and I knew it would provide me with a peace of mind. I purchased a home for $66,000. Over the years, I've refinanced a few times to cover expenses, take advantage of lower interest rates, and to do some repairs and cover college expense for my son. When things seemed like they were under control, my mother developed, a medical condition, forcing her to no longer be able to work, and I had to take over paying her bills. My mother has now been diagnosed with dementia, and I am now her primary caretaker. She receives Social Security payments to cover her insurance and her medicine, but little is left to cover food and basic expenses. When I contacted my lender, they told me that they would happily refinance my loan again to help me cover the increased balance on my credit cards and to pay off my son's school expenses. They suggested that I go to another lender to get a second mortgage, as my home had plenty of equity and it could help me pay the bills. I followed their advice and took out a second mortgage. This finally solidified my situation for a few years until the price of gas and utilities rose sharply. I depend on my car to get to work. Making ends meet became so difficult that I had to dip into my savings accounts until it was depleted. And at this point, I turned to taking out loans on my 401k until I no longer could be allowed to do so. Despite the financial stress, I was able to keep making mortgage payments for several months. However, I finally missed my first payment in September of 2008, and as I ran out of ways to get extra income, I attempted to work with my lender several times, but was not given any option for resolutions. I had to turn to my neighbors to help pay for food for me and my mother. I missed a few payments, received warnings of foreclosure from my lender when I finally was able to get in contact with National Community Reinvestment Coalition, NCRC. NCRC was able to arrange a workout only to find out that the lender on my first mortgage was unable to find an acceptable workout solution. This caused my lender on the second loan not to offer anything because the first was not modified. As the days passed and the foreclosure sale date approached, I decided to move out of my home because my mother's doctors didn't think she could handle being thrown out on the streets. I began to move out on February 22, 2009, into a rental apartment with my mother. We awaited until NCRC got us a resolution. The lender canceled the foreclosure sale, and I was put into a three-month HAMP trial period. Because the modification on the first loan, my second loan holder was able to reduce my monthly payments by $100. But this news we return, with this news we returned to our home in April. The landlord, however, asked me for 6 months of rent, claiming I had broken the lease. NCRC then stepped in again and is engaged in negotiation with the landlord. When I received the first trial modification, I made two payments on it, but then was sent another agreement to begin in June 2009 with a different payment amount. I made my payments for 5 months, only to be told that it was denied because of missing information. This was not the case, as we had submitted all documents to them. NCRC tried several times to get them to reduce the amount I owe, but was not successful, even though my house is worth less now than the amount currently owed. After they declined me again, my counselor at NCRC went back to the lender, asked them to review the file once more for the program. After several weeks of being told that I was in foreclosure again, I began to panic. I thought that we had already fixed everything back in April of 2009, but we were still in a back and forth. I do not understand how this works, and became frustrated to the point of crying almost every night. I have listened to everyone that has helped me, and through the hard work of so many people over at NCRC, I hope that this is the last modification that I received this week, will be the final one, and will be approved. I have had 4 HAMP trial modification loans. I hope that you can take my situation to heart and understand that these issues face real people, and the decision that you make affect us all. I don't understand how I can be told 1 month that we are okay and everything is on track to be modified, begin the trial period, and have it turned down because it seems to be technicalities. It seems to me that if I owe more than what my house is worth, they could just reduce what I owe to the value of my home. Thank you again for your time. I hope you can provide some help to other homeowners like myself who are struggling to get by every day but want to pay their bills and take pride in owning their homes. Thank you again.
Ms. Stringfield, thank you very much for testifying in front of this subcommittee. And in a moment, I'm going to ask some questions of you to try to bring out more about the plight that you and your family have experienced, which is really something that many Americans are experiencing. It's my time for questions. I've got 5 minutes. I want to start with Mr. Scheel. You showed pictures of a neighborhood in Cleveland, but you get around the city a lot because that's your job. Would you say that this effects of the foreclosure crisis in Cleveland's residential neighborhoods is just based on what you've seen, is it pretty evident as you get around?
You can't miss it. Cleveland, as you know.
Make sure that mic is on. Would you try again?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, go ahead.
You can't miss it. You could go into every neighborhood. You know, when we show pictures like this, one of the things that we're concerned about is, do people think we just went and took the one bad street in a neighborhood and took it? I could have pointed my camera in probably almost every neighborhood in Cleveland and found similar scenes. And as Treasurer Rokakis indicated, he has the statistics. Ours is just visceral. When you go out into suburbs now, you can start to see this as well. Right. And it is just, it's a rotting. And I think, Mr. Chairman, what's significant when we talk to local people there, they want to save these neighborhoods. They still have the infrastructure of neighborhoods in place. But in 5 years, I don't think that infrastructure will be there.
Well, thank you, Mr. Shield, for your, again, for your testimony to this subcommittee. Mr. Rokakis, you've made a case about instability in neighborhoods in Cuyahoga County. Can you talk about how principal reduction would make a meaningful difference? And what have loan servicers said about it?
Chairman, I've been involved in this crisis now actually for about 9 years. We went to the Federal Reserve Bank of Cleveland back in the fall of 2000 with complaints about what was going on with loans and lending in Northeast Ohio in the hopes that the Fed would step up under HOEPA and take some measures to slow the runaway train down. So I've been involved with it going back to late 2000, very intensely involved in the past, let's say, 5 years with banks and counselors and workouts. And I have to tell you that I'm exhausted. And I find that the tools that we really need, as long as these are all voluntary agreements, we're right where we were when we started this process years ago. As long as all we have is maybe a carrot but no stick, as long as all we can do is rely on the goodwill of the banks, the words voluntary and the phrase bank loan modifications, typically don't go together. And what we have found, I'm not surprised by the low percentage of workouts. We've experienced this for years. It's hand-to-hand combat. I think the one tool that we would like to have is the tool that you and other members alluded to, Congressman Turney. If we had the ability to force principal reductions of loans, I think we could pick a number, triple, quadruple our success of loan modifications. Mr. Chairman, what I find stunning is that when they refuse to modify those principal loan balances, typically the loan, they end up foreclosing, the family ends up leaving, the property ends up being vandalized, the home value is completely lost as opposed to partially some of the value lost, and it destroys remaining value left in neighborhoods. If we had the ability to force principal loan modification write-downs, I think we could make a real impact on this problem, but we're losing hope, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Mr. Rokakis. I'd like to go to Ms. Stringfield. I want to know a little bit more about your experience with the lending industry. You said that you've been able to refinance your home over the years, and since you bought your home in 1988, for about 20 years, you managed just fine with your payments. Now, all the time, could you tell us, were you marketed by your lenders?
Yes. They contacted me.
Did they try to get you to refinance?
Yes. How are you doing? How is things going? Are you having any problems? Things a little rough right now.
What do they tell you about the kind of money you could get? What kind of loans you could get?
They could that I could refinance my first mortgage.
For how much?
Depends on what I needed. Like,
did they tell you your home was worth $420,000?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, when I talked to them, I told them that I took the loan out for 66, and when I refinanced with them, it was...
You told them what?
66,000.
And they wanted to refinance 420,000?
Because that's what the guy came back with that did the appraisal.
So what happened?
They came back, well, the first time they came back with the 422, I don't need that much. They says, well, you can get another 50,000 on your home, and that would pay your son's college. It would help you with your bills. Okay. And it's not going to make your payment that much more.
So they kept trying to get you to borrow more and more money on a house that wasn't worth.
When it turned out, when I came back to them and said, listen, I need to restructure my loan because my mom is really ill. I don't have any money. I need to get this restructured. I don't want to default on loan. All I want you to do is restructure it. Let me lower the interest, get it where I can handle it. And they says, well, we'll have to send somebody out and do the appraisal. This appraisal came out, and he valued the house at 325.
Wow. Now, when you told, you know, you're getting this value of the house keeps getting bigger as they want to loan you more money.
Yeah.
Question is, did you ever have a discussion with them about what happens if you get in trouble paying a loan back?
Oh, yeah. I asked, I says, well, you know, right now I don't have this money. What if I don't get, oh, Mr. Stringfield, you'll be all right. You know, you can always work it out. We can help you.
They'll work
There's
with
not going
right?
to be any problem. We'll work with you.
Did they work with you?
No.
What happened when you fell behind?
When I got in trouble, the first thing I did was from the literature is call your mortgage company. Let them know before you get in trouble. I called before I got in trouble. I was told we can't do anything until you are 1 month late. Well, ma'am, I'm trying not to be 1 month late. The day of that call was May 3rd, 2008. And at that time, they told me I'd have to write a letter. May 15th, that letter was in their office because I faxed it in, along with a financial report of my earnings and what I had going on. They then had Hope Now contact me. The Hope Now representative said, Ms. Stringfield, you're overextended. You need to let your house go. I said, sir, I've been in this house since 1962. Why would I want to let go of my home? Well, you can't afford it. What you need to do is let go of the home and contact D.C. or Maryland and try to get into one of the welfare homes.
Now, you eventually did get in touch, though, with the National Community Reinvestment Coalition. Right.
Right? A friend of mine told me about them.
Did they help you?
They have helped me.
Well, I want to thank you for your answer to the question, Ms. Stringfield. We're going to go now to Mr. Jordan of Ohio for any questions you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To our witnesses, thank you for being here. And you all were here, I believe, when Ms. Caldwell gave her testimony. Do you think the HAMP program has demonstrated significant progress over its 1 year?
I can't speak to the results in Arizona, California, Nevada. I saw the chart just like, I can only speak to the results in Ohio, and I can speak to the results in the community I represent, and the chart speaks for itself. We're third from the bottom. I spoke with a group of housing counselors who were on a conference call last week. I believe Mr. McCarthy was in on the call, and I found it interesting that one of the comments made by folks on the phone is they felt that servicers were more willing to work out a $500,000 mortgage in California than they were to work out seven $70,000 mortgages in Toledo or Cleveland or Dayton. And they felt that they had prioritized which mortgages were really worth their time and energy. Now, they might bristle at that suggestion, but I heard it from too many people on that phone call and others. So I think that chart, you have to look at that chart that we posted up on that on those slides. We're third from the bottom.
No, significant progress or not?
Pardon me?
Significant progress or not?
In my role, I don't like to, I'm not going to comment per se on government, you know, I'm not going to comment on whether a government program's making progress or not. I will say viscerally, just going around Cleveland, and I bet in Dayton and Akron, you can see, you don't really, the charts prove it. But if you just tour the neighborhoods, I don't know whether it's this program or not, but there is an evident decline.
Yeah.
I've been covering Cleveland for 20 years. The neighborhoods do not look like what they looked like two decades ago.
Mr. Rokakis, you talked a lot about the counseling program. This is a local counseling program, is my understanding? Local people?
There are four counseling agencies we work with. I mentioned ESOP because at the request of the Attorney General and the Governor, ESOP expanded statewide. They have 11 offices around the state. They're very effective in doing what they do.
But there are people in Ohio helping Ohioans figure out what's at stake, what's involved, how their mortgage works.
Face-to-face counseling, not a call-in number, face-to-face counseling, which, as Congressman Cummings pointed out, is the most effective.
Understand. In your professional judgment, years of experience with this, years of being in Cuyahoga County, years as the treasurer of that county, something as a conservative Republican I believe in is, don't you think we'd be better off, instead of having this $75 billion program, 116,000 mortgage modifications done, 3 million the goal, but only 116,000 done in 1 year, might we just be just a little better off if we said instead of going with this crazy program, let's take a few of those dollars and let local people help local people, people like Ms. Stringfield, if she were in Ohio or in the case of D.C. here, help them with some counseling, help them deal with it on a local level versus this concept that we just have so embraced around this town over the last year and a half, big federal government with regulations and spending taxpayer dollars and doing all the things they're doing. I think maybe that might be a little better approach.
I have seen two programs now. One was a program under the prior administration. I've seen this program, and obviously both have fallen short. The only thing I can tell you is nothing beats face-to-face counseling, one-on-one.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
local people helping local folks. The difficulties, big federal government. The difficulties faced by Ms. Stringfield, just multiply that by millions of homeowners like her who try to navigate these complicated
right.
documents, mortgages being sold once and twice and three times, servicers that aren't responsive. Nothing works better than a counselor.
Yeah, I just want to make clear, big federal government programs administered by Republicans are no better than big federal government programs administered by Democrats. That's the problem. So something on the local level done with a lot less dollars would be much better for the folks who are in a tough situation and, frankly, much more respectful of the taxpayers across this country who are paying for the darn thing.
I'd love to avoid those layoffs on Monday. Unfortunately, there are a lot of people going to be looking for help in Cleveland and Ohio on Monday that are going to get a tape-recorded message sending them to an 800 call-in number.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jordan. The chair recognizes, Ms. Kaptur.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing. I'm really honored to join my Ohio colleagues, and I want to thank this panel for being here today. What's left of democracy in this country, we are helping to move forward by your presence. And we are up against some pretty big forces. What's happened in Cleveland and in Washington and every place else is the largest transfer of wealth in American history. That has come from the equity, from the heart of America, and transferred to a group of people in some of the biggest banks in the world, here in our country on Wall Street and down there in Charlotte, North Carolina, who have no conscience for what they have done. In fact, their bonuses this year will be bigger than last year. Those banks are Bank of America, J.P. Morgan Chase, Wells Fargo, HSBC, and Citigroup. I was going to ask you, Ms. Springfield, and thank you very much for being here today, which bank were you dealing with? Are you allowed to say?
Wells Fargo.
Thank you. So it's on the list. The whole conversation about servicers in a way is irrelevant because you can't get at them. They're cleverly sandwiched in between the big banks who have all the power and are making all the money despite the unemployment rate of this country and people losing their homes, and Main Street America. You just can't get them. And in fact, by the servicers extending the servicing period, they're making fees all the time. So they're making more money out of your grief. So they have no incentive, even though it looks like HAMP gives them an incentive to try to settle, forget it. They're making more money through the tax code and through servicing fees by letting the agony continue. It's interesting we don't have a list of who the 100 and 110 servicers are. We'll ask Ms. Caldwell to provide that for the record. But we have to put the pieces of this puzzle together. What didn't come out at most of the hearings in Congress yet is the securitization process failed. The banking system's been changed to not provide accountability and responsibility for those who created the damage. It's a very clever system. It is so clever. You have to have master's degrees in order to create, probably PhDs, to create this kind of house of cards. But they've done it masterfully. We need to restore the mortgage loan process so, Ms. Springfield, you're not dealing with somebody way out there, but you've got a financial institution here in the nation's capital that you can deal with face-to-face and you don't have to go through some absentee counselor here and some group here. But in fact, that the prudent lending system of this country is restored. And that's the real fight, because the net yield of all of this over all the crisis that the American people are facing right now is that the biggest banks that caused this problem, five of them, now hold over 40% of the deposits of this country. It used to be 35, 33. They're going to get half. Five institutions are going to have that much power, and they have that much power. I was interested in what several of you recommended. Mr. Rukakis, you're a giant in my eyes. Thank you so much for what you're doing, and don't lose faith, because this is the process that should restore America or at least we have some hope of it happening if we do our job right. And I want to thank our chairman. He's got the courage of his convictions, and he's trying to help us in a Congress that's really locked down and not holding the kinds of hearings. Ms. Stringfield, we should have 1,000 Americans like you testifying. But this Congress isn't meeting its responsibilities to the people, and our people are suffering all over this country. So your presence here today is very important, because it's like water in a desert. And so you're doing what you must do on behalf of many that are not being invited to testify by the other committees that should be a part of this. The idea of principal loan modification should be being done like that. And if the Securities and Exchange Commission and the Accounting Standards Board and the FDIC were doing its job, that would be happening. But they're not. They're not. And so what's happening is the net yield is those that caused this and have profited so handsomely, grossly, unethically, are being rewarded. And the only way that this changes is if conscious people in the press, like Mr. Scheel, you keep doing your job. And Mr. Rukakis, don't lose hope, don't lose faith. You keep doing your job. And Ms. Stringfield, you work with the Community Reinvestment Group. They're wonderful. We have to keep doing our job and take this to America, because the people are losing hope. And we haven't lost hope. So this process really does work. And on the good news front, Secretary Geithner was before our Budget Committee yesterday, and I would like to suggest to the chairman, he offered that Ohio could meet with him. We take him up on that offer. And in fact, I was going to call you, Mr. Rukakis, because I said, I know an expert who's not in my district, but an ESOP and many of the other groups. Through the chairman's efforts here, maybe we can structure a session with Mr. Geithner, either directly by bringing people to Washington or through teleconferencing, where we can get the Treasury, and they shouldn't be the only ones in the room, we should have the FDIC and the SEC, and some bankers who really know how to resolve troubled loans on books, in that room, and try to make it work for Ohio. And if we make it work for Ohio, it'll work for the rest of the country.
To respond to my colleague's question and suggestion, this subcommittee, in fact, and myself as chairman, we are in touch with Treasury and Mr. Geithner's office about this specific matter. And I'm glad that he responded to you, because I'm hopeful that he'll be similarly responsive to meeting with Ohioans in the Congress who want to see what can be done to try to save all these homes that are being threatened. If nothing's done, we could come back here a year from now, and what we'll see is the kind of maps that Mr. Rokaka has presented today, just widening. There won't be any open space at all. And we'll know there'll be more people with Ms. Stringfield's story, and there'll be more reporters who will be covering neighborhoods across America that are boarded up and abandoned. I have to tell you, we're going to dismiss this second panel right now, but when I saw, Mr. Shields, your report, and I saw the claw of that steam shovel go into the house, I actually could feel that. I come from a neighborhood like that. I mean, I represent people in those neighborhoods. We all do. But I come from a neighborhood like that. The neighborhood in Slavic Village, in my district, I know the people who lived in homes like that. I know how people put their entire life on the line to get that kind of a house, who work day and night, who work their fingers to the bone to be able to just have a little something, to have a piece of that American dream, which is called home ownership. And then you see the big claw just crushing it. It breaks your heart. It really does. Thank you all for being here with this testimony, and really much appreciated. We're going to go to the third panel. Thank you. While the panel's in transition, I'm going to make the introductions of the credits of the individuals who are going to be before us. They have quite a number of accomplishments, and I think that By the time they're seated, I'll still be reading those accomplishments. Mr. Daniel Berenbaum is the Chief Program Officer of the National Community Reinvestment Coalition. It's an association of 600 community-based organizations that promote access to basic banking services, including credit and savings, to create and sustain affordable housing and job development. Mr. Berenbaum is responsible for coordinating NCRC's fair housing and fair lending compliance initiatives, and he also manages NCRC's housing counseling network, which with its affiliates is HUD-certified housing counseling intermediary participating in the Neighborhood Works Foreclosure Mitigation Counseling Program. Ms. Julia Gordon is Senior Policy Counsel at the Center for Responsible Lending. It's a non-for-profit, nonpartisan research and policy organization dedicated to protecting home ownership and family wealth by working to eliminate abusive financial practices. She specializes in legislative and regulatory policy issues relating to consumer lending, particularly in the area of mortgage lending. Mr. Ronald Ferris is the president of Aquin Financial Corporation, Aquin Loan Servicing, LLC, served as director of Aquin since May 2003 and as president since 2001. Prior to serving as president of Aquin, he has held numerous executive positions there and served as controller for a subsidiary of Aquin. He's also served as general audit department of in the general audit department of PricewaterhouseCoopers LLP. Finally, Mr. Ed Pinto served as executive vice president and chief credit officer for Fannie Mae in the late 1980s. Since then, he has worked as a consultant to the financial services industry, focusing on credit policy, marketing, and product development. He's published research, commentary, and views, which are regularly cited by numerous major newspapers, magazines, and think tanks. I would ask the witnesses stand. It's the policy of our Committee on Oversight and Government Reform to swear in all witnesses before they testify. I'd ask that you raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you. Let the record reflect that each of the witnesses has answered in the affirmative. I ask that each of the witnesses give a brief summary of your testimony. Please keep this summary under 5 minutes in duration. I want you to know that your complete written statement will be included in the hearing record. Mr. Berenbaum, you're a first witness. Please proceed. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Chairman Kucinich, Ranking Member Jordan, and other distinguished members of this committee. We are honored to testify today before you regarding mortgage reform, mortgage foreclosure prevention, and the activities currently underway to suggest improvement in this area. Solving the foreclosure crisis is critical for the economic health of this country. Since the onset of this crisis, $7 trillion household dollars wealth has been lost. This loss of household wealth translates into reduced consumer spending, depressed business activity, lower gross national product, lower property tax receipts, and higher local and state budget deficits. Foreclosures not only impact individual homeowners, but entire neighborhoods through declining property values, increases in abandonment, decay, crime, and vandalism. In short, the continued failure to adequately address this crisis multiplies the profound social, cultural, and economic injury of to our nation. The foreclosure tsunami has been further compounded by the highest unemployment rates in the last quarter century. In a vicious cycle, the record rates of unemployment and reduction in wages are now feeding continued foreclosures. In the face of this great recession, the Bush administration encouraged the private sector to create the Hope Now Alliance. The Hope Now Alliance recorded 3.1 million loan workouts during 2007 and 2008. But two-thirds of these workouts deferred or rescheduled borrower payments without lowering monthly payments. Meanwhile, the foreclosure crisis worsened. Subsequently, the Obama administration created two programs, the Home Affordable Modification Program and the Home Affordable Refinance Program. Unfortunately, as has been noted already both by the chairman and the ranking of the minority member, these programs are not keeping pace with the foreclosures that we are seeing today. Our written testimony discusses in detail the origins of the crisis, problematic non-prime and non-traditional lending, compounded by regulatory failure, greed and malfeasance, little or no fair lending or consumer protection oversight, and serious safety and soundness lapses. an analysis of the public information that is available documenting the performance of each of the programs is in our written statement. The experiences of our housing counseling network, qualified housing counselors around the nation, as well as the testimony of Mrs. Patricia Stringfield, document the importance of HUD counselors in this process. However, the magnitude of the foreclosure and unemployment crisis calls for more proactive intervention, and that means a private partnership between both government officials as well as servicers, investors, securitizers, and others. Despite the best of intentions, we are not seeing results in these programs because of their voluntary nature, and a more considered mandatory approach should be taken. Yesterday, the Mortgage Bankers Association announced a voluntary unemployment borrower bridge to HAMP modification programs. That will help a limited number of borrowers who experience temporary unemployment for a period of up to 9 months. It certainly will not address the pre-existing problematic underwriting that occurred, overvaluation, or serve as a substitute for permanent principal reduction or other programs, such as NCRC's Help Now model that we have suggested in our testimony. The Help Now model originated in discussions with Wall Street. It uses Wall Street's own reverse auction process to, in fact, promote the sale of large groups of mortgages, mortgage-backed securities, to Treasury or another agency. It could also be, for example, other departments. It could be HUD. But using the current market value of the homes and then passing those savings on to the homeowners so they have principal reduction, and in turn selling those loans back as 30-year, 40-year fixed-rate loans to the private sector at little or no cost to the taxpayer. Authority for this program exists under the current TARP program, it exists under eminent domain, and frankly, it could be done with modest changes to the tax requirements if, in fact, Congress chose to act in that direction. As well, we want to see loan programs established for the unemployed, such as H.R. 4173 passed by the House, as well as more broad interpretation for principal reductions within the HAMP program. Substantial research documents that the most successful loans, the loans that are not falling out of permanent modifications, are in fact loans that have had principal reduction. Last week, the administration announced a $1.5 billion initiative to target 5 states. We agree with this committee that, in fact, a much more broad need is necessary. There is no reason to focus on volume or size of loans over the quantity of modifications that are currently needed across our nation. In closing, let me say that we also suggest other improvements for HAMP. Those improvements include greater transparency and reporting of data. It includes also expanding areas of the law in judicial modification, as well as expanding and modernizing the Community Reinvestment Act. Thank you.
I thank you, Mr. Berenbaum, for your testimony. Ms. Gordon, you're recognized for 5 minutes. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Chairman Kucinich, Ranking Member Jordan, and members of the committee. Thank you so much for inviting me today to talk about the government's response to the foreclosure crisis. We need a much more robust and effective plan to save homes and prevent unnecessary foreclosures. Over 6 million homeowners are now behind on their mortgages and at risk of foreclosure. More than 2 million foreclosures have occurred in the past 2 years alone. By 2014, researchers predict that up to 13 million foreclosures may have taken place. This crisis has been particularly hard on African American and Latino communities, widening the already sizable wealth gap between whites and minorities and wiping out entire formerly middle class neighborhoods. The spillover costs are massive, including lost property values, even for homes current on their mortgages, erosion of the tax base, and the increased burden on municipal services. Before I talk about the details of foreclosure prevention, I want to refer to the many people who will try to convince you that this crisis was caused by public policies aimed at expanding the American dream of homeownership to all communities. This claim is nothing short of outrageous and insulting. Every single bank regulatory agency has pronounced this allegation false, and there is no good data to back it up. This foreclosure crisis was caused by toxic loan products that were sold to people for profit purposes and that preyed particularly on the communities that I've mentioned above. Most borrowers could have qualified for cheaper mortgages with less risky terms, And the vast majority of these loans weren't even sold to first-time home buyers. These products were designed to become affordable within a couple of years so that mortgage brokers could refinance the same customers over and over again, like Ms. Stringfield, and receive a fee each time. Wall Street's appetite for risky loans was seemingly insatiable, and lenders scrambled to deliver more loans to keep the money coming. It's also not true that unemployment right now is the culprit rather than bad lending. Risky loans are approximately three times more likely to default, no matter what the underlying economic conditions or where you live. In fact, during every other period of high unemployment in recent decades, foreclosure rates remained essentially flat because people had a home equity that could cushion the blow. In responding to this crisis, the government so far has given the most help to the people who need it the least. Programs to lower mortgage interest rates and the home buyer tax credits have helped support the housing market in the face of historic levels of default, but haven't helped the people at highest risk of losing their homes. As we've discussed already, the centerpiece of the administration's foreclosure prevention effort, the Home Affordable Modification Program, has not reached its potential. A key obstacle impeding HAMP's success is that the private servicing industry has been either unable or unwilling to do the job they need to do. Originally, the HAMP program was meant to be coupled with other legislative changes that would have backstopped the program and provided other incentives for servicers to perform, but those legislative changes did not occur. As a result, HAMP is essentially a voluntary program where homeowners themselves still have no power or control over their situation. Participating servicers routinely violate the program's guidelines and fail to convert performing trial modifications into permanent ones in a timely way. Homeowners are given very little information about how their loan modification request was evaluated, and they have no independent appeals process if they believe their request was denied unfairly. In our written testimony, we've laid out a number of detailed suggestions for improving HAMP. What I want to focus on here is the importance of requiring servicers to reduce the principal balances for underwater homeowners. Being underwater is the most accurate predictor of default or redefault, and until mortgages are right-sized on a routine basis, it is unlikely we'll see the end to this cycle of redefault. We also need action outside of HAMP to make HAMP work. A law requiring that servicers evaluate all homeowners for loan modification prior to initiating foreclosure could give homeowners the right to fight their foreclosure if such an evaluation were not conducted. It's also crucial to permit judicial modifications of mortgages on primary residences. This solution costs nothing to the U.S. taxpayer. It's the only solution that cuts through the Gordian knot of second liens, securitizations, negative equity, and back-end consumer debt. Finally, we need common sense rules that prohibit lenders from making loans that borrowers can't afford, and we need an independent consumer financial protection agency. If there's nothing else that we've learned from this crisis, it's that it's much easier and far less expensive to prevent problems than to clean up after them. Thank you so much for inviting me today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you for your testimony. Chair recognizes Mr. Ferris. You may proceed.
Thank you, Chairman Kucinich, Ranking Member Jordan, and distinguished members of the subcommittee for the opportunity to participate in today's hearing. My name is Ronald Ferris, and I am the president of Ocwen Financial Corporation. At Ocwen, we share your sense of urgency to find a lasting solution to our nation's daunting foreclosure crisis, a crisis that threatens millions of families with the loss of their home. Ocwen is not a loan originator. We did not make the bad mortgages that are causing the problems. But as a loan servicer, we are doing everything we can to fix them. We were the first in the industry to adopt a comprehensive loan modification program, one that provides homeowners in distress lower mortgage payments that are both affordable and sustainable and result in greater cash flow for investors than from foreclosure. We are proud to have saved well over 100,000 homes from foreclosure since the onset of the mortgage crisis through loan modifications. Ocwen supports the administration's HAMP program. We believe it is a well-designed response to the mortgage crisis. Even so, almost a year into HAMP, too many homeowners facing foreclosure are having difficulty getting their loans modified. In our view,
This is due mainly to a lack of sufficient capacity and expertise in the industry to handle the volume. Ocwen has invested over $100 million in R&D to build our own loan servicing technology. Our platform is both scalable for high volumes and incorporates behavioral science research for effective customer communication. Using technology, we have been able to convert trial modifications to permanent modifications at a rate that is 10 to 20 times higher than the big banks in the program. But the key metric for long-term success is the redefault rate. According to a recent industry report, three-month redefault rates on HAMP mods have ranged from 18 to 33%. Through our technology advantage, we have kept our redefault rates to below 5%. As part of Ocwen's continuing commitment to make HAMP a success, we would like to share with the subcommittee some of our recommendations for program enhancements. First, the required debt-to-income ratio should be lowered to below 31%. One out of every four HAMP applications is rejected for failing to meet this standard. Usually these are families struggling with higher household expenses for food, clothing, and education. HAMP should instead use a flexible residual income approach to determine a payment that the homeowner can actually afford. Alternatively, there should be either an across-the-board DTI of 28% or a sliding scale DTI that varies based on the number of dependents on the borrower's tax return. Second, principal reduction modifications are needed to overcome the negative equity problem. This is a primary driver of defaults on mortgages, and redefaults on modified mortgages, 11.3 million mortgages in this country, or 24%, are currently underwater, and these numbers will likely grow. In Ocwen's experience, negative equity increases the chance of a redefault by 1.5 to 2 times. Accordingly, approximately 15% of all of our loan modifications have involved some element of principal reduction. HAMP already addresses principal forbearance, but there is no provision for principal forgiveness. We believe step principal forgiveness is best. That is incremental principal reductions over time, so long as the loan remains current. Third, additional funding should be made available for housing counseling groups. Grassroots organizations like NCRC, who is here today, ESOP in Ohio, Home Free USA, National Council of La Raza, and so many others around the country are providing much needed homeowner outreach and counseling. We urge financial support for any HUD certified counseling organization assisting homeowners through a successful permanent modification under HAMP. Fourth and last, underperforming HAMP servicers should be required to outsource to performing servicers. Whether for lack of effort or just an inability to handle the volume, too many banks are not producing the results needed to achieve program goals. Treasury should be empowered to redirect servicing to those with a proven track record and available capacity to execute trial modifications and convert them to permanent solutions. Let me conclude by thanking you again for inviting me to testify today and asking that my full written statement be entered into the record. Thank you.
And it is so ordered. And thank you, Mr. Pinto. You may proceed for 5 minutes. Thank you.
Chairman Kucinich and Ranking Member Jordan, thank you for the opportunity to testify today. Let me first provide some background regarding the cause of the foreclosure crisis. Chart one demonstrates the loan-to-value ratios and foreclosure rates that have been increasing in this country for decades. You'll see that FHA has been leading the way for decades also in rising loan to values. FHA's foreclosure start rate now stands at 32 times the level that it had in 1951. The collapse of the mortgage market had a single cause, the accumulation of an unprecedented number of weak loans. In 2008, approximately 50% of
I'm going to ask the gentleman to suspend. We got to make sure we can hear you. You need the mic.
Okay, sorry.
And speak into it. Thank you. Thank you, staff.
Thank you. The collapse of the mortgage market had a single cause, the accumulation of an unprecedented number of weak mortgages. In 2008, approximately 50% of outstanding single-family mortgages were weak and prone to failure, with two-thirds being the result of federal programs. How did this happen? In 1995, the federal government issued its National Homeownership Strategy. It required the use of flexible and alternative lending in, quote, an unprecedented public-private partnership to increase homeownership, to to record high levels over the next 6 years. With this national policy in place, the lending equivalent of Gresham's Law took place. Weak lending drove out good. Turning to the administration's home affordable modification program, I'd like to recall HAMP's original goal that still is posted on their website: to help as many as 3 to 4 million financially struggling homeowners avoid foreclosure by modifying loans to a level that is affordable for borrowers now and sustainable over a long term. The Treasury Department has consistently painted rosy scenarios regarding HAMP's progress. In an apparent desire to post big numbers early on, the concept of a trial modification was introduced. Borrowers were allowed to enter a trial without qualifying on the basis of income. This wasn't fair to borrowers who had no chance of qualifying. Many will be worse off than if they'd been given a quick no and encouraged to find alternative housing. As a result, the HAMP pipeline became hopelessly clogged, with the lion's share of the blame, in my opinion, falling on Treasury. The January 2010 HAMP report contains a statement that strains credulity. It noted, quote, "The program is on pace to meet its overall program goal of providing 3 to 4 million homeowners the opportunity to stay in their homes," close quote. That was not the goal. The truth is HAMP has been a spectacular failure when measured against that goal. In the first 11 months, there's been 116,000 homeowners who've received permanent modification. Subtract expected redefaults and you might end up with 75,000 homeowners who are saved from foreclosure, about 2% of the goal. I predict that ultimately HAMP will only meet a small percentage of its 3 to 4 million foreclosure goal. The same redefinition of program goals applies to HARP, Treasury's refinance program. It was to help 4 to 5 million homeowners shut out from refinancing because their current loan to value is above 80%. Through December 2009, Fannie and Freddie have completed 190,000 HARP refinances, less than 5% of their goal. Not a problem. Making Home Affordable 2010, January 2010 report now takes credit for 4 million refinances of all type, regardless of LTV. Treasury promised transparency. What we get are disingenuous progress reports when it comes to program goals. This committee and the American people deserve an honest assessment of what HAMP and HARP can do. Why is the problem so intractable? We're facing a more challenging situation than ever because credit standards were severely compromised by federal policies prior to the onset of the current crisis. What delinquent borrowers in the housing market needs is triage that provides quick answers and fast decisions. This will allow the shadow inventory of millions of defaulted loans that cannot benefit from a modification to end up in the hands of qualified homeowners. Late last month, Treasury announced changes to HAMP process, which should help meet the goal of providing quick answers and fast decisions. It will hopefully put an end to no-doc trial modifications. Unfortunately, the changes do not take effect for 3 more months. One last note, in Ms. Caldwell's testimony, it's noted that $2 billion in savings have already been recognized by HAMP participants, and administrative action has kept interest rates at historic lows. But I think we must be honest. There is no free lunch. Tens of millions of Americans, many pensioners, living on their savings, many of your constituents, are suffering a real loss of income due to these low rates. Households in this country own $11 trillion in fixed assets. Many are now earning about 2% less than previously. That's over $100 to $200 billion a year in lost income and tens of billions of dollars in lost taxes. Thank you and look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Pino. There's no such thing as a free lunch, but apparently there's multi-billion dollars in bonuses for bankers who got TARP. So we'll have to figure out how that squares with folk wisdom. I heard Ms. Gordon correctly talk about the root of the crisis. And I think we should be clear that this foreclosure crisis started well before the current administration came into office, and it is rooted in policy decisions that created the largest asset bubble in American history, an $8 trillion home mortgage bubble. So to call this crisis a subprime crisis would miss the point. The bubble was created by Federal Reserve policies that kept interest rates low for the explicit purpose of allowing home prices to inflate, knowing and expecting and tacitly encouraging that homeowners would use their rising home values to supplement stagnant wage incomes. using a house as an ATM wasn't a product of greedy and irresponsible homeowners. It was a product of a shrewd but ultimately disastrous government calculation and policy. And American workers have been the biggest losers in this crisis so far. They're the ones who have been thrown out of the workplace in large numbers, had their hours reduced, their benefits cut. They're the ones who have been forced to give up their family homes, endure bankruptcy, and the ignominy of public foreclosure proceedings. So labeling this crisis subprime crisis would really be blaming the victims. The crisis was not caused by people who lost their homes and their life savings, their jobs, and their reputation. It was caused by people who perpetrated what I think is kind of a hoax. Responsibility for the crisis and repairing it, the damage falls on every person and every institution, including past and current representatives of both members of Congress, or both parties in Congress, rather, as well as the last administration, and this current administration now has the responsibility, who should have been and are responsible for assuring the ethical and financial integrity of our banking and monetary system. We're picking up the pieces here. Now, Mr. Birnbaum, you mentioned in your testimony the role of credit rating agencies in influencing loan servicer behavior, making them to be more inclined to act on a delinquent loan first by foreclosing on it, then modifying it, and only as a last resort, cutting principal. Can you elaborate how credit rating agencies influence this process?
Certainly, Mr. Chairman. There's unfortunately more and more growing evidence now that the SEC failed to appropriately regulate or monitor the credit rating agencies in this nation. And the way the system worked, in fact, it worked toward incentivization of profit and simply affirming whatever paper was presented before those rating agencies. They actually even called themselves publishers of information rather than, in fact, reviewers of that information. This also led to significant fair lending issues because if you look at, in fact, many of the AAA ratings that those agencies gave, subprime, non-traditional, it was to companies such as AmeriQuest, New Century, and others, which has impacted not only on Ohio, but frankly, low to moderate income communities across the country.
Thank you, Mr. Birnbaum. One final question, Ms. Gordon. Are there legal solutions to the obstacles that some might see in doing principal reduction for borrowers?
I'm not sure what you mean by legal solutions, but one of the obstacles right now is that a number of these loans held by investors have second liens on them. About half of all securitized loans have a second lien.
So does Treasury have leverage to get around that?
Well, you know, Treasury has a program. Treasury unveiled a program in spring of last year, the 2MP program, designed to try to attack the second lien program, but no servicers have used it. I had heard that Bank of America has now signed up for it. I don't exactly know what that means, but as far as I know, no one has yet used the 2MP program in the HAMP program. It seems to us that Treasury should require servicers to use the 2MP program to resolve these second liens, which are essentially worthless at this point in most cases.
Thank you. Mr. Jordan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Gordon, do you believe that HAMP is, do you believe HAMP is working at all? Do you think it's, a pretty bad program? You think like I do. You think the track record of HAMP is
It's clearly underperforming what we need to do to get ahead of this crisis.
Okay, so here's where I'm a little confused, because in your testimony you said federal policies had nothing to do with contributing to the mess that we got in. You said the government had nothing to do with contributing to the mess we got in, even though the track record of government trying to fix it is pathetic.
The federal policies I'm referring to in that section are, there's been a lot of talk about how the Community Reinvestment Act and other policies, in fact, I think Mr. Pinto mentioned this earlier, are somehow responsible for the toxic loan products, when in fact, for the most part, the loans made under CRA were safer loans and ended up having a much better performance profile than the risky loans that were made outside of that system.
Mr. Pinto, is that an accurate statement, the loans, the one that Ms. Gordon just made relative to the Community Reinvestment Act?
The accurate part of the statement is most Community Reinvestment Act loans were fixed rate, lower interest rate loans. If you compare those loans to other fixed rate loans that had higher interest rates, my research shows that the default rates on this low the CRA loans are also high. I give you one example, ESOP with Third Federal Savings, and ESOP has testified a number of times about the great job that Third Federal had done. What they haven't testified about is the performance of those loans. These were CRA loans, low interest rates, they were subsidized generally. They're running a 37% delinquency rate on a $300 million portfolio. Third Federal has suspended the program mm-hmm. and because of its poor performance.
Do you agree with my statement that I made in my question to Ms. Gordon that federal policies, I know you agree with this, federal policies help get us in this mess. How in the world are federal programs going to help get us out of it? I mean, I come from this whole thing. If big government spending, big government programs are going to get us out of this economic concern we've been in, well, heck, we'd have been out of it a long time ago because that's all we've been doing for 2 years. I mean, we have seen things we never imagined we would see in the United States of America. So I just don't, and we can't even get now Treasury just to comply with, I mean, if you were here for my earlier question, Ms. Caldwell, we can't even get them to comply with what the Inspector General wants them to do on the original no doc loan getting documentation. I mean, it just highlights and underscores when you travel down this road, you end up making things worse. And when you attempt to solve it, what you do is put a lot of taxpayer money at risk and not really help the people who I agree with my colleague who has passion. I mean, we all do. You don't really help the folks who, frankly, need some help. So
I
comment on that.
Let me just comment that in the first quarter of 2009, the OCC-OTS puts out their mortgage metrics report. And there were 190,000 modifications that were done in that quarter. There were about 150,000 that were done in the second quarter. This is before HAMP got ramped up. There was a growing tide of those, heavily growing tide into interest rate reduction, much like HAMP. Since then, the number of modifications reported has declined, and I believe we're going to end up seeing that the $190,000 loan number that existed in the first quarter won't be surpassed in 2009. So it's actually slowed down the process. And I think my suggestion is focus on Fannie and Freddie, which I think are 60% of HAMP,
huge.
And let the private sector on their loans deal with them the way they were actually doing many things back in early 2009.
Homeowners would be better off financially. They get some quicker remedy, whatever, you know, quicker action, whatever that would be, and we could focus on where the bigger problem is, Fannie and Freddie.
Right.
Great point.
I thank the gentleman. Chair recognizes Ms. Kaptur.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This has been an outstanding panel, and I thank you very much for coming today and what you've placed on the record. Several witnesses today, including many of you, recommended principal write-downs. Let me offer the observation that I don't think servicers can do principal write-downs. Many servicers have business with the five biggest banks that caused this mess to begin with, coupled with the changes in the banking laws back through the 90s that changed prudent lending to securitization. And local banks holding a portion of those loans, and we moved it to a bond. We changed a loan to a bond, and they sold it to everybody on the face of the earth. And so the collectability issue, Mr. Pinto, you used three words, collateral, credit, and capacity. I always say character, collateral, and collectability. There's no collectability. And so how do you do the loan workout? How do you do the normal accounting changes? That's where I want to go, by using FDIC, SEC, and those involved in that given loan. I don't think we can get it through the servicers. I think HAMP is proving that. We can't do it. So we need to be able to do what we did back in the 80s. We need to be able to work out those loans get the assets and liabilities to balance on those books, and there's going to have to be some real estate write-downs. We're going to have to get down to some level within the banking system, and that is what is not happening. And I wanted you to comment on that. I wanted you to comment on two things for me. One is your view of servicers being able to solve this problem through HAMP, even as you ask for principal write-downs. And if you were to recommend to the president how to rearrange what he's doing in order to get at this real estate crisis so we don't have millions of homes vacant across this country, how would you tell him to, who would you tell him to bring into his office, the Oval Office, all these agencies, so we can get at the value of real estate and do loan workouts where we can get them done? So I want you to comment on the principal, write down who can actually do it, I don't believe the servicers can. And then what would you say to the president to get to where you want to go and help us to move the housing market to a more positive position and keep people in their homes?
Ms. Kaptur, if I may jump in, I think that's an excellent question, and I'll respond quickly to allow each of the panelists their opportunity. Right now, there's an over-reliance in balloon payments by servicers across this country, so really there is no principal reduction. Frankly, what we are hearing from the investor community is that they are ready to begin some serious principal reductions, and to paraphrase, they are ready to take their share of the haircut that's necessary to correct the marketplace. But the system right now is loaded with conflicts. For example, you noted earlier that a majority of the seconds are held by the banks, the same banks that operate the majority of the servicers in this nation. Conflict number one. Conflict number two is some of the accounting rules that we've been discussing in this presentation and before this hearing as well. Issue number three, we have to get beyond the blame game. Everyone is at fault. There is shared blame here. And if we are going to move ahead, we need to ensure a meaningful regulatory restructure that embraces the Community Reinvestment Act for what it has done in responsible lending for community reinvestment. We need to embrace a strong consumer financial protection agency, and we need to work with responsible servicers and lenders who are willing to do business in the way that is required to bring trust back to the market that you spoke to earlier. We are not going to see global investors or pension funds or others buy in the secondary market until those minimum requirements are made. Last, one more point that I'd like to make is that we do need to focus on the HARP program as well. Ultimately, who owns that $400 billion of risk right now? It is not the private sector. It is the taxpayers. What a wonderful way to go about, in fact, reaching 70% of the outstanding mortgages by, in fact, reducing the risk associated to the taxpayer through principal reduction. We have the power to do that through eminent domain or through the power of Congress.
Thank you. Ms. Gordon, did you want to say something there?
Well, I agree with most of what Mr. Berenbaum has said. I will note that servicers in serving accounts that are held in portfolio seem quite able to do principal reductions. There are principal reductions happening. They're just not happening for the securitized loans.
And what percent are represented of the portfolio of securitized loans?
Well, you know, that depends on the servicer. So, but in terms of the troubled loans, quite a lot of them are securitized. The places where the portfolio loans are doing the most principal reductions is with respect to payment option arms, which for the most part are so underwater, not only because they're located in some of these highest price decline states, but also because they had negative amortization built into the loan. These loans are very poorly served by HAMP. You know, HAMP can't really help them for a variety of structural reasons. So it, you know, it's clear that the problem does have to do with these conflicts of interest, and I completely agree with you that not all of the banking and securities regulators that need to be at the table seem to be at the table rowing in the same direction with the Treasury's program. I know the folks at Treasury, you know, despite my concerns about the underperformance of the program, I know that they're trying their best, but there needs to be a team approach here, and we already know that the prudential regulators have not had a history of putting consumer interests at the top of their agenda. You know, that's why it's so important to have an independent Consumer Protection Agency. But most of all, this is why it's so important to do things like change the bankruptcy code. I mean, ultimately, you need someone to just, who has the power to cut through all of this, regardless of the various interests and conflicts involved. We already have a system set up in this country for that. The entire bankruptcy system does just this. Principal residence mortgages are the only type of debt that can't be restructured. Your second home mortgage can be, your yacht can be, but not the home that you live in and have made your life in.
Thank you very much for your testimony. I want to thank all the witnesses. This is the Domestic Policy Subcommittee, joined by my colleague, Congresswoman Kaptur, and we've had a full hearing today with many members of Congress testifying and or rather participating. I'm Congressman Dennis Kucinich, Chair of Domestic Policy. We are going to continue our work on this issue, and we are going to continue to work for a serious program of principal reduction in order to help keep people in their homes. Thank you very much. Adjourned.
Turn when he gives into his most shocking cravings.
I want that guinea pig out there.
I've eaten iguana, actually. It was the worst tamale I've ever had in my life.
Anthony Bourdain, No Reservations, Ecuador, returning Monday at 10, only on the Travel Channel.
Let's recap the beaches we've been to so far. In at number 10 is the action-packed Hyatt Regency Aruba Resort and Casino. Our number 9 pick, Caneal Bay St. John, is a dream come true for romantics. At number 8, it's a pirate's life for those seeking privacy at the Parrot Key Resort and Spa on Parrot Key Island. In at number 7 is the tropical wilderness of Little Dick's Bay, Virgin Gorda. Our number 6 selection, the all-inclusive Beaches, Turks and Caicos Resort and Spa, left nothing out. We're putting on the Ritz at our number 5 resort, the Ritzy Ritz-Carlton St. Thomas. Number 4 is Four Kinds of Wonderful for Golfers, the Four Seasons Resort, Nevis. Number 3 is where families discover Atlantis on Paradise Island. And our number 2 selection is second to none for spa. It's the Sandy Lane Resort, Barbados.